Good evening, all the participants. We are now playing ICAI Moto Song. I request all the participants to put their right hand on their hearts. Thank you. Friends, I welcome you all on this seventh and the last day of our webinar series on GST. Though it is a last day, but it's beginning of unlockdown 2.0, because today morning, as our honorable prime minister announced, that we are going to have a lockdown till 3rd May, and I'm sure that these GST webinar series will give you a time to unlock another days of this lockdown. But I want to acknowledge the efforts of our dynamic chairman, under whose leadership we all are able to get ourselves unlocked from our home. It is none other than CA Fenil Shah, chairman of Ahmedabad branch. I request now our chairman to give his opening remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Bishan bhai. The speaker of the evening, and you can say the last day of this GST webinar series, none other but CA Advocate CA Puneet Agarwal ji from New Delhi. The chairmen of various other branches joining in this webinar: CA Vinay Sakaria from Rajkot branch, CA Bhavesh Thakkar, CA Manoj Goyal Bhavnagar branch, CA Jitendra Thakkar Bhuj branch, CA Karan Thakkar Gandhidham branch, and CA Deepesh Bhuj Jamnagar branch. The Indirect Tax Committee Chairman of Ahmedabad branch, CA Rahul Maliwal, and Secretary CA Bishan Shah, and the members attending from all over India, I welcome you all to this last day of this webinar series. Friends, again, I request you to, before all the COVID funds which are right now operating, and you can contribute to society in as many number of ways as it's possible. Plus, friends, we all are responsible citizens. I yesterday also told you, so it's our first duty that we become helping hands to government. And for that, what is the need is to download the Arogya Setu app. So we all should do that because it has various benefits. From branch side, friends, in Ahmedabad, we are making an effort that during this lockdown, we are trying to connect with some government officials, and let's see positively if we get the permission. Then we will be coming up. Ahmedabad branch will shoot a mail up, will shoot you up a mail that for certain time period, using our membership card, we will be able to go to our office and we can get the data from there, certain important documents from there to home, so that we can efficiently work from home in this lockdown 2.0. These efforts are going on, so let's hope once it turns out to be a fruitful thing, we will serve your mail with respect to that. Plus, also, friends, in this lockdown 2.0, try to as much as you can contribute to the research activity which branch has communicated, to you by the email. So, friends, right now, the right medium to communicate from home with government is Arogya Setu app, and with branch, it is the branch email ID. So keep on going through whichever email comes, and whatever expectations you have from us, kindly mail us. We'll be more than happy to come up and serve you with all those things. And lastly, friends, you might be aware of that now we can sign the audit reports and certificates digitally by using the electronic signature. But at the same point of time, taking the UDIN is must. Also, the clarification of the same will be served to you from the branch mail ID. So at the end, this being the last day, I thank you from bottom of heart that all the whole of this webinar series was possible because of two constructive pillars. One is CA Bishan Shah and another is CA Rahul Maliwal. Without their effort, it would not have been possible. So thank you to both our own secretary, sir, and our Direct Tax Committee Chairman, sir, and treasurer to make this series CA Light of the Day. Thank you. And now I request Rahul to take the session further.
Thank you so much, Chairman, sir. Now, good evening to everyone. Welcome you all on the last day of the Advanced GST series. The topic for the today's session is the valuation under the GST. And as we all know, the Section 9 itself, the levy says the levy of the GST arises on the value to be determined under Section 15. And today we are going to learn about the valuation aspect. The faculty for the today's session is Master Blaster of all, and a person who is always having a smile on his face. Puneet sir actually required no any introduction, because when you broadcast any film, the hero is not required to be introduced. But just for the sake of the requirement, I would say that sir is an advocate by profession and also a chartered accountant. The very famous judgment of Suresh Kumar Bansal in Service Tax defined the stature of the Puneet sir itself. At the same time, I would also like to take that our chairman Fenil sir has given us the vision to make the notes for all the seven days series, so that we can give a compiler of the all the 7 days to our members and the participant. To make this particular compiler, I would like to appreciate the efforts of the CA Abhishek Chopra, CA Naveen Khandelwal, CA Praveen Maheshwari, CA Jay Dalwadi, CA Arjun Akruwala, CA Chirag Jain, CA Devam Seth, CA Hitesh Kriplani, CA Rahul Hiren Patak, CA Rahul Shah, CA Vaibhav Shah, CA Harshit Patel and CA Utkarsh Desai for their tremendous efforts. Thank you so much. Now I would request Puneet sir to take the session forward. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Rahul bhai. Thank you, Fenil ji. Thank you, Bishan ji. It's a real pleasure to be amongst all of you. And professionals have done an amazing task by getting together in this process of learning and in this process of self-improvement. This definitely is an event which would be marked in the history books. But success of humanity depends not on the size of the problem, but the way in which the human beings deal with the problem. And I think this country, which has the wisdom, which has the knowledge, and which has this characteristic of love for all, would help the whole world carry on with a future which would be much more brighter and more successful. And I wish all of you, our professional community, all those who define the professional world, all the very success, more and more success after the opening of the lockdown and after we get over this problem. And I'm sure we all would emerge not just victorious, but also with lot more strength and lot more courage, with lot more knowledge, with lot more wisdom. We will be able to stand up with our motto song, Yayesha Supteshu Jagrati. And with that, I would like to start with today's discussion, which has been given to me. It's very heartening. Before I show you the screen, before I show you the provision, that now we have developed and evolved so much as professionals into GST that we have started to discuss the provisions, and not just the provisions, the genesis of the provisions. Rahul bhai started by saying that the levy section itself says that the valuation shall be under the provisions of section 15. So though I originally planned to discuss 15, but he has made me change my mind, and I want to first go to section 9 to also show you one more thing, because that would be very relevant for our today's discussion. Let me go to the provisions of not section 15 but section 5 9 first. This small little section 9(1) actually define the basic contour of the whole GST law. All the four essentials of taxation are contained herein. I need not labor on them. I need not bother too much on that. What I want to state is, and what I want to bring your specific attention to, is the fact that section 9(1) says, subject to provisions of 2, there shall be levied a tax called CGST on all intrastate supplies of goods, etc., except on supply of so and so. Now, on the value determined under section 15 and at such rates not exceeding 20%. So if you kindly see, as may be notified, then it is continued by saying, as may be, so rates are to be notified. We all know that. As such, the rate of tax is not today's discussion. But what I want to bring your attention to is that neither the value nor the rate can stand on their own feet. Actually, what happens is that computation of tax is a function of value and the rate. So therefore, taking an example, we all know that, but I am only building the foundation for my discussion. If you have supplied goods and the value in terms of the provisions of this act is, say, 1000 rupees of those goods, then the value alone would not serve the purpose, unless the government notifies a rate to it. But what is very important is the fact that the statute itself doesn't give the rate of tax. It leaves it to the delegatee, namely the government, to provide the rates of tax by way of issuance of notifications. But what I want to bring your attention to this section is the point that the cap for rate of taxation is 20%, and that 20% is the function of the value which is to be determined in section 15. So there is some great sanctity to this cap of 20% applicable to the value. You may kindly, at this moment, I will pause on this aspect. You may kindly just note it somewhere in your mind, and when we discuss later the specific situations, the specific problems, at that time, I would explain what the significance of this is. So now, moving on to section 15. If you see section 15, let us first discuss the bare section, because what we will do is, in each of the clauses of this bare section, there are some very, very, very important fundamental principles that are involved, and we will keep relating the examples to those. We will keep relating the case laws to those and try and understand and develop as to what this provision of section 15 says. But prior to discussing this, I would like to take you to slightly the historical basis on which indirect taxes used to apply. If you see, the Central Excise Act, which used to be there prior to the new Section 4, which came in the year 2000, the tax was actually applicable on a base which was called as the normal price. So under Central Excise, there used to be a concept not of transaction value, but of normal price. So they wanted to see that what is the ordinary price that commodity would fetch in the market. Likewise, in the customs also, there used to be a concept which was not the concept of the transaction value, but the normal price. So what is the value of the commodity in the international market, they used to see, and on that basis they used to apply the customs duty. But when liberalization started taking place, then general agreement of trade and tariff etc were entered, then came the era where slowly and gradually we started moving towards a transaction value based regime, and the change was first brought out in the customs law, and thereafter it was introduced in the central excise law also, where the normal values, I'm not on the exact specifics as to what were the expressions used in those respective statutes, but I want to bring on the point that initially there was a time, and if you go and see those legislations 25 years back from today's date, you would find, or 40 years back from today's date, you would find that the regime under which valuations were done were not on transaction value regime. But slowly and gradually, we started moving towards a transaction value regime where they used to say that lease tax on the actual value which has been transacted between the parties. And why they used to say that? Because after all, these are all commercial taxes. These are all taxes which traders and commercial people have to bear. And if they have to bear, the government said that let's not substitute our wisdom. Let us tax the values which they themselves are considering and they are putting up to the goods. Or later on, it became services. So you would find that service tax was actually never on any regime basis except the transaction value. So that's how we started moving towards a regime which was more concentrated towards the understanding of that regime by the businessman himself, rather than substituting the wisdom by the government. So from moving from control regime to the businessman regime. In that light, let me read this section 15.1. It says the value of a supply of goods or services or both shall be the transaction value. And thereafter, it goes on to define that transaction value. So it says, which is the price actually paid or payable for the said supply of goods or services or both. I pause here for a while. And if I may just explain this, the expression you would find which is used is, which is the price actually paid or payable for the said supply. Now, if you go through section 2 of the CGST Act, or for that matter of any other IGST or SGST, etc., UTGST, you would find that the expression price is not defined. That would mean that we need to take the meaning of this expression price as it is ordinarily understood by those who deal with such like laws. This is called the common parlance test or the commercial parlance test. This has been elaborated in various cases. The notable of those, for example, is the Budhia Prasad judgment, where the question was regarding betel leaves, whether it would be considered as a vegetable or not. They said, don't give it a botanical meaning. You give it the meaning which is given to it by those who deal in it, because taxes are to be paid by those who deal in it. So here we have to give meaning of the expression price. And this concept of price in the context of commercial world and in the context of commercial laws is actually used in Section 4 of the Sale of Goods Act, which could give us an indication as to what the price would mean. And if I may say so, the expression price here means the monetary value, namely the sum which is paid in money. So for example, let us take an example. If a shopkeeper sells a book for 200 rupees to a buyer, then this 200 rupees is the price of the book. But let's assume that a person takes a mobile phone to a shopkeeper and gives him his old mobile phone. The shopkeeper gives a new mobile phone for 5,000 rupees and also keeps the old mobile phone. Then this mobile phone, the old one, that is not the price. Price is still the 5,000 rupees only. But now if I continue with the section, you would find what it says, where the supplier and the recipient of supply are not related and the price is the sole consideration for the supplier. So they are saying that if there is the if the recipient is paying money in exchange for what has been supplied, and that money is the only consideration, the price is the only consideration, in that case they are saying take the price as the transaction value, which was our example number one. But where there is an additional consideration, where price is not the sole consideration, what does it mean? That there has to be some additional consideration. In that case, they are saying that transaction value would not be the basis. That we will see then what shall be the basis. So what I want to first of all emphasize is the expression price in section 15 subsection 1 should refer to the amount which is paid in cash. Cash means anything which is considered to be equivalent to cash, by check, by RTGS, by transfer, by money account settlement, but as it's represented in terms of money. Let me here also give you one example which arises from a judgment which was passed by the Supreme Court. It is a judgment by Justice Sinha in Dhampur Sugar Mills case. In this case, what happened was, I'm giving you a simple example to explain. I'm not going to the exact facts. A person agreed to buy, let us say in our own example of this old and new mobile phone, the shopkeeper actually quoted the price of the new mobile phone, let us say at 8,000 rupees. And the buyer had that old mobile phone, which he showed to the shopkeeper, and shopkeeper told him that this I am ready to buy at 3,000 rupees. So then they agreed, all right, I am buying this old mobile for 3,000. I am selling this new mobile for 8,000. But of course, rather than giving that 3,000 first to the buyer and then buyer giving 8,000 to the seller simply takes 5,000 rupees from the buyer. So it is a case of set off. In that case, in case of Dhampur Sugar Mills, Justice Sinha said that this is not a case of barter. This is actually a case of sale of old mobile phone also, and a case of sale of new mobile phone also. Another example, which will come in 15.2, so therefore let us keep it for that. It is also a related example. So what I want to say is that if the commodity or the service which is being supplied, the price is available as a full price, but thereafter parties decide to set off that price with something else, then section 15.1 would actually apply. But if the original bargain between the parties is that the one of the party is either giving his consideration only in form of non-monetary sum, or in a form which includes money and also non-monetary consideration, then he goes out of 15.1, because transaction value for that transaction is not available to the party. And there is element of some goods or some service also coming into picture. In that case, 15.1 will not. That is case number one. Case number two is 15.1 has another exception. It does not regard transaction value as the value for the purpose of payment of tax in those cases where supplier and recipient are related parties. And we all know the reason. It is obvious that the relationship may change the price. Relationship may give rise to influencing the price. So rather than it being an arm's length transaction value, it may become a affected transaction value. It may become an influenced transaction value because of the relationship. Therefore, the section keeps it out. So to sum it up, value for the purpose of taxing under section 9 is the transaction value. To the transaction value is applied the rate of tax. Rate of tax is provided by way of a notification. Transaction value is the sale price. If the price is actually paid or payable for the supply, provided only two exceptions are there. Either there is a relationship between the parties, then price is not the transaction value, or if the price which has been transacted between parties is not the only consideration. If there is something else over and above the consideration, then also it would not be a case where you can go with the transaction value. There definitely some other thing has to be done. You will see and proceed and see what happens in that case. Now I come to 15.2, which are specific inclusions. I want to say one thing here. 15.2, on a reading of it, on an analysis of this, you would find that some of the clauses of 15.2 are actually in addition to 15.1, and some of the clauses are actually only clarifying the scope of 15.1. Even if they would not have been there, it would not have made any difference. Let us see how and why I am saying this. First of all, it says it's an inclusive clause. The value of supply shall include. You all know that what is the meaning of means and includes definition? 15.1 is means definition, 15.2 is inclusive definition. So this adds on to whatever is there in 15.1. So what, even if 15.1 doesn't contain all these, doesn't include all these, 15.2 would have the effect of additionally adding all these if they are not already included. Let us see what does 15.2a says. Any taxes, duties, cesses, fees, and charges levied under any law for the time being in force other than this act, the SGST Act, the UTGST Act, and the Compensation Cess Act, if charged separately by the supplier. Isme aap chahe to ek cheez aur add kar sakte hain, kyunki wo baad mein unhone rules ke through add kiya. Jo Kerala ka compensation, jo Kerala mein ek unhone cess specially lagaya tha, usko bhi by way of rules they have stated that wo bhi exclude hoga. तो वो एक जस्ट एडिशन है इसमें कि वो भी एक्सक्लूड हो जाएगा, वो इंक्लूड नहीं होगा वैल्यू के. दैट्स ओनली वन थिंग व्हिच इज प्रोवाइडेड एंड आई विल टेल यू द रूल नंबर आल्सो दैट आई विल टेल यू. बट व्हाट इज इंपॉर्टेंट इज लेट मी गिव यू अ लिस्ट और एग्जांपल्स. फॉर एग्जांपल there may be some other fees which may be charged. Let's take example of goods sold in a mandi. You are all aware ki mandi mein jo goods supply hote hain, jeera, dhaniya, haldi, sabjiyan, fruits, they are chargeable to an amount and a sum which is called as mandi fee. Actually that is not a tax, it is the concept of fee. You might be aware fees are those statutory charges jo lagte to statutes hain, but they are against some consideration. So state does something and against that consideration, against that doing, they charge a fees. The examples of fees may be the fee for making a passport, the fee for making aadhar card, etc. All these are examples of fee. To wo jo amount hai, agar wo, let us say kisi ne kisi ko dhaniya becha 800 rupees kilo, और 800 रुपीस केजी में ही एड्स ऑन द मंडी फी एंड लेट अस अज्यूम दैट इट इज 1%. तो 800 प्लस 8, व्हेन ही चार्जेस दैट अमाउंट, द सेलर सेज आई एम चार्जिंग 800 रुपीस एंड आई एम आल्सो चार्जिंग 8 रुपीस. सो दैट अमाउंट ऑफ टैक्स व्हिच इज बीइंग चार्ज्ड, दैट आल्सो गेट्स एडेड फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ वैल्यूएशन अंडर जीएसटी. इसी तरीके से अगर टोबैको पे डुअल लेवी है, टोबैको पे एक्साइज ड्यूटी टोबैको एंड टोबैको प्रोडक्ट्स पे, और उसके ऊपर जीएसटी भी है, तो दैट पोर्शन वुड आल्सो फॉल हियर एंड टोबैको पे जो एक्साइज ड्यूटी लगी दैट वुड आल्सो फॉर्म पार्ट ऑफ जीएसटी. और इसके ऊपर आपको याद भी होगा दैट इट इज वेल सेटल्ड बाय बॉम्बे टायर इंटरनेशनल एंड बाय एमआरएफ दैट सेल्स टैक्स एंड एक्साइज ड्यूटी आर टू डिफरेंट इम्पोस्ट्स एंड एक्साइज ड्यूटी कैन बी इम्पोस्ड and sales tax can also be imposed simultaneously on the same goods because they are on two different transactions and for the purpose of valuation. Even excise duty can include sales tax and sales tax can include excise duty because that is all legislative discretion. It is because they say that the government which has the power to impose tax on a particular incidence has very wide power to define on what basis it want to charge the duty. Because you would remember then in those cases what happened, the assessees said that excise duty cannot be imposed on the sale price because that includes not just the manufacturing cost and the manufacturing profit, but also post-manufacturing cost and post-manufacturing profit. The Supreme Court said no, the legislatures have very wide discretion. So here, applying those principles, they say that all the taxes would be included. Of course, they say that these taxes themselves, namely the GSTs, would not be included. But if on first principles we were to ask ki kya agar ye provision na hota to GST include ho jata, so the answer is yes, GST include ho sakta tha, koi manai nahi hai. In fact, agar aap George Oaks ke naam se ek judgment agar aap usko padhenge, usme precise question ye tha ki sales tax lagane ke liye sales tax include hoga ya nahi hoga. To court ne kaha ki yes, sales tax bhi jo aapne charge kiya wo bhi sale price ka hi actually part hai. So therefore, applying that, they could even include that. And they also answered the question ki kya legislative jo legislature hai uske paas power hai ki wo sales tax ko include kar le sales tax lagane ke liye. The court said yes, they can. So however, here they have excluded the GST but have included all other taxes and fee. Main ek example aur deta hu aapko. Liquor ki trade mein aapne dekha hoga ki bahut sari license fee lagti hai aur bahut sari license fee aisi bhi hai jo sale ke upar lagti hai. जैसे हो सकता है एक होलसेलर, अगर मैं आपको एक एग्जांपल देता हूं, जैसे दिल्ली में एक्साइज ड्यूटी नहीं लगती बिकॉज दिल्ली में कोई लिकर मैन्युफैक्चर नहीं होती. तो दिल्ली में क्या होता है कि जो प्राइस होता है उसके ऊपर यहाँ की जो स्टेट एक्साइज वाले हैं वो एक फीस लगाते हैं. तो जो इम्पोर्टर है, लेट अस से किसी ने इम्पोर्ट किया इंडिया के बाहर से फॉरेन लिकर, उसने उस फॉरेन लिकर के ऊपर प्राइस चार्ज किया 100 रुपीज, उस पर उसको होलसेल लाइसेंस फी के नाम से एक लाइसेंस फी देनी है. वो अपने बायर को वो चार्ज कर सकता है और करता भी है. तो वो उसमें 100+400 रुपीज की होलसेल लिकर लाइसेंस फी लगाता है, 500 रुपए टोटली बायर से कलेक्ट करता है. तो वो जो 400 रुपए भी वो कलेक्ट करता है, इवन दो वो गवर्नमेंट को एज इट इज पे कर देता है, तब भी वो 2A में फॉल करेंगे एंड दैट वुड ऑल बिकम पार्ट ऑफ द वैल्यू ऑन विच द जीएसटी इज पेबल. लेट्स मूव फर्दर. ये बड़ा इंटरेस्टिंग है, मैं इसके ऊपर भी आपको एक केस बताऊंगा एंड यू विल रिकॉल. एनी अमाउंट दैट द सप्लायर इज लायबल टू पे इन रिलेशन टू सच सप्लायर बट विच हैज बीन इनकर्ड बाय द रिसिपिएंट ऑफ द सप्लायर एंड नॉट इंक्लूडेड इन द प्राइस एक्चुअली पेड और पेबल फॉर द गुड्स और सर्विसेज और बोथ. आप इसको एक बार ही ध्यान से पढ़िए क्योंकि इसमें कई बार बड़ा कंफ्यूजन हो जाता है. लेट मी रीड इट अगेन फॉर यू. Any amount that the supplier is liable to pay, तो इसमें liability किसकी है? उस amount को pay करने की liability supplier की थी, but which has been incurred by the recipient of the supply, but उसको actually pay कर दिया recipient ने, and not included in the price actually paid or payable for the goods. और क्योंकि supplier ने अपने पास से pay कर दिया, तो it is not included in the price. इसका मैं आपको एक example देता हूँ. जो हमने अभी example एक लिया होलसेल लिकर के केस में, जो मैंने अभी एग्जांपल लिया कि 100 रुपीज का प्राइस था प्लस 400 रुपए की उसके ऊपर होलसेल लाइसेंस फी थी, तो उसने 500 रुपए चार्ज किए 100+400 एंड द बायर पेज टू हिम 500 रुपीज, 500 बिकम्स द वैल्यू. नाउ अज्यूम फॉर अ मिनट दैट रादर देन द सेलर पेइंग दिस टैक्स और नॉट द टैक्स द फीस होलसेल लाइसेंस फीस, एक्चुअली द बायर गोज एंड पेज इट टू द गवर्नमेंट. So what would happen? The buyer would pay 400 rupees directly to the government. He would pay 100 rupees to the supplier and supplier would not charge 400 rupees from the buyer because buyer has already paid that money. This actually device was used by McDowell and that issue went to the Supreme Court in the famous case of McDowell's, which we study for the purpose of the difference between tax evasion and tax avoidance. Aap sabko yaad hoga, there is a very famous decision of the Supreme Court which laid the fundamentals, the theory that tax avoidance is also to be frowned upon. In that famous case, Justice Chinnappa Reddy laid the foundation as to what is the meaning of the expression tax avoidance, and he said that in a country like India, tax avoidance may not have a space of its own and therefore we have to be very careful. He said that devices which are formed only to avoid tax are to be looked down upon and they are to be disregarded for the purpose of taxation. And the facts in that case were the same as I am giving this example. In that case, the buyer, rather than the seller depositing his duty, because what happens in liquor, more than the price of goods is the excise duty element. So what was happening was buyer was directly depositing the excise duty element, which was payable by the seller. In that case, what happened was that the Supreme Court said that since the liability to pay, now this is the distinguishing feature, kindly listen to this very carefully. The Supreme Court said, since the liability to pay excise duty is always on the seller, because it is on the manufacturing activity, therefore, if the buyer discharges that liability of the seller, he is doing nothing but paying price to the seller. So Supreme Court ne ye kaha ki jo ye 400 rupaye buyer ne de diye, ye basically kuch nahi hai. Usne zarur jaake sarkar ko jama kare, lekin wo actually wo seller ko hi price de raha tha uske goods ka, kyunki usko to duty ki liability hi nahi thi. अब आप अगर इस सबसेक्शन 2 के बी को पढ़ेंगे तो ये वही तरह के केसेस को कवर करता है. अगर यहां ना भी लिखा होता तो भी वो इंक्लूड होता. मैं एक एग्जांपल और देता हूं आपको, ये आपके लिए प्रैक्टिकली भी बड़ा यूजफुल हो सकता है. मान लीजिए कि किसी कॉन्ट्रैक्ट के अंदर लिखा हुआ है कि जो सप्लायर है उसको बायर के गोडाउन तक गुड्स पहुंचाने हैं, और उसके प्राइस में बायर के गोडाउन तक का प्राइस ही है, और उस केस में ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी भी बायर के प्रमाइस पर ही होती है. ऐसा हो सकता है कि कोई कॉन्ट्रैक्ट ऐसा कहता हो. बट हुआ क्या कि सेलर ने बायर को बोला कि मेरे को ट्रांसपोर्टर जो है वो आराम से नहीं मिल रहा, सो ही आस्क द बायर टू अरेंज फॉर द ट्रांसपोर्टर. व्हाट द ट्रांसपोर्टर डज इज ही पेज द प्राइस टू द ट्रांसपोर्टर. लेट अस से the bargain was 10,000 rupees, the goods which were to be supplied by the seller were 10,000 rupees, which included transportation at the end of the seller. The buyer directly arranged the transporter, paid 500 rupees through the transporter, and deducted that sum from the seller's account, and seller made an invoice only of 9,500 rupees. In that case, this provision says that since it was the liability of the seller to pay to that person, therefore, if the buyer pays, it is of no avail, that would still be included in the value. But now let me take an example which is different from this. Let us say the contract on the very first point was only for supply of goods ex factory of the seller, and the seller under the contract was to charge only 9,500 rupees. In that case, if the buyer sends his transportation, then he is not doing something which was actually the obligation of the seller. He is doing his own obligation. Then the value of transportation would not be included. So therefore, it would depend upon either the governing law or it would depend upon the governing facts of the case. Aisa bhi jo maine case aapko abhi bataya, वो केस भी स्टैट्यूट से कवर्ड है. एक बड़ा फेमस जजमेंट है, आप चाहे तो नाम लिख लें, हिंदुस्तान शुगर मिल्स के नाम से. इट वाज रिपोर्टेड इन 43 एसटीसी. इन दैट केस व्हाट हैपेंड वाज कि जो सीमेंट कंट्रोल ऑर्डर्स, जो डिफरेंट डिफरेंट कंट्रोल ऑर्डर्स होते हैं, उन कंट्रोल ऑर्डर्स में ये रिक्वायरमेंट थी कि जो सेलर है उसको बायर के यहां तक गुड्स पहुंचा कर देने हैं, और वही वो प्राइस चार्ज करेगा वहां तक का प्राइस. तो कोर्ट ने यह बोला कि क्योंकि उसकी जिम्मेदारी बायर के यहां तक पहुंचाने की थी, इसलिए फ्रेट जो उसने एक्स्ट्रा भी चार्ज किया वो अमाउंट भी इंक्लूड होगा, क्योंकि उसकी लायबिलिटी गुड्स की उस पॉइंट तक थी, सेलर के यहां पहुंचाने तक. तो देयरफॉर दैट द प्रिंसिपल इन दैट जजमेंट विच अरोज एंड विच वॉज ऑल्सो फॉलोड इन मैकडॉवेल ने उसको फॉलो किया, वॉज देयरफॉर दैट व्हाटएवर इज द लायबिलिटी ऑफ द सेलर अंडर द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट, that is to be included. और वो लॉ से भी आ सकती है liability, वो contract से भी आ सकती है liability. अब आते हैं हम C के ऊपर. Incidental expenses, including commission and packing, charged by the supplier to the recipient of a supply, and any amount charged for anything done by the supplier in respect of the supply of goods or services or both, at the time of or before delivery of goods or supply of services. So if you look at this, first of all, it is talking about incidental expenses and is including commission and packing. But the more important thing is that these are all charged by the supplier to the recipient. ये issues बहुत आया करते थे excise वगैरह में, तो फिर उन्होंने इसको इसके ऊपर बहुत झगड़े हुए. So then they are therefore clarifying that anything which is charged over and above the price by the supplier, क्योंकि बहुत बार बहुत सारी ऐसी जगहें हैं जहां पर वो लोग कुछ एक्सपेंसिस को एक्स्ट्रा चार्ज करते हैं ओवर एंड अबव द प्राइस ऑफ द गुड्स. दैट इज द वे इन विच दे चार्ज द प्राइस. जैसे मैं आपको कुछ एग्जाम्पल देता हूँ. पैकिंग के चार्जेस होते हैं, ये सेक्शन में एक्चुअली भी लिखा हुआ है, बट पैकिंग के चार्जेस कई जगह पे अलग लिए जाते हैं जो विच आर इंसिडेंटल एक्सपेंसिस. उसके अलावा देर आर चार्जेस विच आर चार्ज फॉर द पर्पज ऑफ लोडिंग दोज गुड्स. तो अल्टीमेटली उसको गुड्स पहुंचाने थे, भेजने थे सब काम, बट वो लोडिंग के नाम के पैसे अलग से लेता है. दीज आर ऑल दोज केसेज वेयर दीज एक्सपेंसिस आर टू बी इंक्लूडेड. बट लेट मी टेल यू अगेन वन थिंग इन दिस केस. अगेन देर इज अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग डिफरेंसिएशन इन which you will find in sales tax laws, जो पहले के sales tax laws थे उसके अंदर ये बड़ा इसी तरह के clauses के ऊपर बड़ी interpretation हुई. मैं आपको कुछ examples देता हूँ. कई states में liquor के ऊपर sales tax नहीं लगता था. वो इसलिए नहीं लगता था क्योंकि वो excise duty और sales tax दोनों की state की power है. तो what they used, the states used to do is they used to charge whatever they wanted in form of excise duty and they didn't want ki hum excise bhi lagaye fir sales tax ko bhi administer kare. Whatever they wanted they charged at excise duty level itself. So what used to happen was ki jab koi manufacturer manufacture karke sale karta tha to liquor was exempted but packing material was not exempted. In those cases the sales tax department wanted to prove that look, packing material in this case is a contract separate from sale of liquor. आपको सुन के थोड़ा examples को आश्चर्य होगा, but I want to give you these dimensions because these are actual cases fought in Supreme Court again and again and again and again. आप चाहें तो नाम भी लिख लें. इस पे एक वासव दत्ता सीमेंट करके एक केस है, एक राजशील करके केस है, उसके बाद एक बाद में जस्टिस सिन्हा का केस आया था, यूपी से आया था, एसोसिएटेड एल्कोहल के नाम से आया था. उस सब में इसी तरह के क्वेश्चंस थे. मैं आपको और एग्जांपल देता हूं इसी तरह के केसेस के. जैसे वीट है, वीट वाज जनरली मेनी अ टाइम्स एग्जेम्प्टेड अंडर टैक्स एंड वीट को जिस गनी बैग में पैक करते हैं एक्चुअली दैट वॉज नॉट एग्जेम्प्टेड. तो उस केस में क्या होता था, सेल्स टैक्स डिपार्टमेंट वॉन्टेड टू प्रूव दैट जो आपने गनी बैग सेल किए हैं उसके ऊपर जो टैक्स लगेगा वो डिफरेंट रेट से लगेगा और जो उस जो उसी गनी बैग में जो आपने वीट पैक करी है उस पे डिफरेंट तरीके से लगेगा. ऐसा सेल्स टैक्स डिपार्टमेंट कई बार स्टैंड लिया. तो मैं आपको ये क्यों कह रहा हूं, बिकॉज ये प्रोविजन वैल्यूएशन का तब तो अट्रैक्ट होगा व्हेन देयर इज नो सेपरेट ट्रांजैक्शन फॉर सप्लाई ऑफ द पैकिंग मटीरियल. लेकिन अगर जो केसेस मैं आपको बता रहा हूं, इन दैट केस इट इज हेल्ड दैट एक्चुअली इट इज नॉट अ केस ऑफ वन सिंगल सप्लाई बट इट इज अ केस ऑफ मल्टीपल सप्लाईज, वन ऑफ द कमोडिटी एंड सेकंड ऑफ द पैकिंग मटेरियल. इन दोज केसेस दिस शुड नॉट अप्लाई बिकॉज इन दोज केसेस पैकिंग मटीरियल वुड बी टैक्स्ड सेपरेटली एंड द आइटम वुड बी टैक्स्ड सेपरेटली. टू इलैबोरेट, द सुप्रीम कोर्ट लेड डाउन द प्रिंसिपल that we have to look at the intention of the parties which can be deciphered from various facts which are underlining the transaction. Jaise unhone kai tarah ke factors diye, unhone bola kya packing material separately trade hota hai inki trade mein, aap ye dekho. Secondly unhone bola kya parties ne separate price tay kiya hai dono items ka ki nahi kiya. Lekin aapko ek baat bata do ki unhone ye bhi keh diya ki separate price nahi bhi hai to bhi ho sakta hai ki separate transaction ho, क्योंकि कोई ऐसे डॉक्यूमेंट्स मिल जाए जिससे पता चले कि एक्चुअली इंटेंट सेपरेटली सेल करने की थी, प्राइस को सिर्फ मर्ज कर दिया गया. उसके अलावा उन्होंने बोला कि क्या पैकिंग मटेरियल रीयूजेबल है, ये भी एक इंपॉर्टेंट फैक्ट है. उन्होंने बोला कि पैकिंग मटेरियल की वैल्यू कितनी है, ये भी एक इंपॉर्टेंट फैक्ट है. तो इस तरीके के जो केसेस हैं, आई एम जस्ट गिविंग यू डायमेंशंस, डिफरेंट डिफरेंट फैक्ट्स में देयर कैन बी डिफरेंट आंसर्स व्हिच यू मे अचीव अल्टीमेटली. सो दिस इज समथिंग व्हिच आई वांटेड टू पॉइंट आउट कि वैसे तो जनरली लुकिंग एट द फेस ऑफ दिस सेक्शन यू विल फाइंड दैट दीज आर ऑल एक्सपेंसेस व्हिच आर टू बी इंक्लूडेड इन वैल्यू सिंपल, बट वेयर इट इज एक्चुअली टर्निंग आउट टू बी अ डिफरेंट कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. मैं एक एग्जांपल और देता हूं आपको. हमने पहला एग्जांपल लिया था कि जो सेलर है ही इज लायबल टू डिलीवर द गुड्स अप टू द लोकेशन ऑफ द बायर. एक एग्जांपल हमने लिया, नो द सेलर इज नॉट लायबल टू सप्लाई द गुड्स अप टू द लोकेशन ऑफ द सेलर, हिज प्राइस इज ओनली एक्स फैक्ट्री. अब आप इसी के साथ एक एग्जांपल और कर दीजिए कि ये वाला जो एग्जांपल है जहां बायर को ट्रांसपोर्टेशन अवेल करनी है अज्यूम करिए कि बायर को ट्रांसपोर्टेशन अवेल करनी थी और एक्चुअली सेलर की एक ट्रांसपोर्टेशन यूनिट भी है, तो ट्रांसपोर्टर जो सेलर है वो दो बिजनेसेस में है, ही इज इनटू सेल ऑफ गुड्स, ही इज इनटू प्रोवाइडिंग ट्रांसपोर्टेशन सर्विसेज. इंडिपेंडेंट ऑफ द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट ऑफ सेल, बायर गोज टू द सेलर एंड सेज कि जी मेरे आप गुड्स यहां से ट्रांसपोर्ट कर दो, उसके पैसे ले लो और उसके लिए बिल्टी बना लो. दैट इन दैट केस द ट्रांजेक्शन ऑफ ट्रांसपोर्टेशन would not be considered to be incidental expenses. It is not incidental to the transaction of supply. It is a transaction totally different from the transaction of supply. Has to be classified separately, has to be taxed separately, cannot be merged along with this. मैं आपको एक example और देता हूँ इस तरीके के केस का. एक बारी ये Acer India का decision है जो लक्ष्मीकांत साहब ने ये argue किया था Supreme Court में, and it's a very interesting case. उसमें क्या हुआ कि कंप्यूटर जो है, कंप्यूटर आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट द प्रिंसिपल, व्हाट हैपेंस इज समटाइम्स दोस प्रिंसिपल्स आर ओवरकम बाय द स्टैट्यूट लॉ. स्टैट्यूट कई बार उन प्रिंसिपल्स को चेंज कर देता है, जैसे कंप्यूटर सॉफ्टवेयर वगैरह के बारे में कस्टम्स ने कई सारे चेंजेस कर दिए. बट लेट अस अंडरस्टैंड द प्रिंसिपल. लेट अस अज्यूम फॉर अ मिनट दैट द कंप्यूटर दैट वी आर बाइंग इन दैट केस वॉज हैविंग Microsoft Windows loaded on it. Take it as an example. That is not the exact case, but that is for the sake of understanding, let's take an example. The question before the court was whether while computing the value of the software, of the hardware which was manufactured by Acer, should the value of software be added or can it be excluded? अब आप सोच सकते हैं कि उस कंप्यूटर के अंदर ऑलरेडी सॉफ्टवेयर पड़ा हुआ है, दिखने में तो वो एक कमोडिटी ही है. The question was asked by the judges to the council of that, how can you exclude this? The answer was, look, in the commercial world, the buyer and the seller treat these two items as separate commodities of trade. The buyers and seller can decide that these are two different items. Therefore, merely putting the software onto the media doesn't mean that software becomes an integral part of the media. It is not a case that a car cannot come without a tire. It is the case where a computer can come without a software. Therefore, the manufacturing activity ends at that place, and thereafter, whatever I am selling is a separate transaction altogether. It is to be taxed separately under the respective statute. If at all tax is to be imposed on software under service tax or whatever, that may be applied, but not by adding it as a value to the computer. So these are all different dimensions which may arise, and in all cases it would not be a case that incidental expenses would, it would be construed as incidental expenses only. It is not like that. So therefore I tried to give you different examples from different cases. Now kindly, if you come to D, the value of supply shall include interest or late fee or penalty for delayed payment of any consideration for any supply. अब आप सबको याद होगा कि सर्विस टैक्स लॉ में स्पेसिफिकली एक्सक्लूडेड था, लेकिन मैं आपको बता दूं कि एक सुप्रीम कोर्ट का डिसीजन था जस्टिस कपाड़िया का, मेरे को एग्जैक्टली नाम नहीं याद आ रहा. उसमें व्हाट यूज्ड टू हैपन वाज कि अगर आपने किसी को सिलेंडर सप्लाई कर दिए एंड यू चार्ज 1000 रुपीज फ्रॉम हिम फॉर द सिलेंडर्स. Thereafter, if he keeps those cylinders for more than a month, you start charging money from him, let's say 20 rupees a month. So the Supreme Court said, because this is for the material that you have supplied, and if you keep the material for more period, you have to pay this money. Therefore, it has to be added. But service tax had a specific provision which excluded interest or late fee or penalty. Now this has been specifically included under the GST law. तो अगर कोई भी डिले के लिए इंटरेस्ट लेट फी वगैरह लगती है तो वो दैट इज ऑल्सो इंक्लूडेड इन द वैल्यू ऑफ टैक्सेबल सप्लाई. बट एक चीज ध्यान करिए कि इंटरेस्ट और लेट फी और पेनल्टी वैल्यू के लिए ऐड कर रहे हैं, तो अगर ओरिजिनल ट्रांजैक्शन टैक्सेबल ही नहीं है या सप्लाई ही नहीं है, इन दैट केस दिस प्रोविजन डजंट अप्लाई. लेट मी टेक एन एग्जाम्पल. लेट अस से अ बिजनेस सेल्स एन ओल्ड प्रॉपर्टी. एक बनी हुई प्रॉपर्टी है, बिजनेस के एक पुराना ऑफिस था, उसने बेच दिया. सेलिंग ऑफ इमूवेबल प्रॉपर्टी, लैंड एंड बिल्डिंग इज नॉट टैक्सेबल अंडर द एक्ट. अब जो बायर था उसने पेमेंट करने में डिले करी, इस वजह से अंडर द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट ही वॉज मेड लायबल फॉर पेमेंट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. That would not be taxable because the original sale of the property that self itself was not taxable. Now let me come to the last inclusion, which says subsidies directly linked to the price, excluding subsidies provided by the central government and the state government. ये भी एक बड़ा interesting inclusion है. ये actually addition ही है मेरे हिसाब से. अगर आप ये law देखेंगे, जो प्राइस होता है, मैं आपको एक एग्जांपल देता हूं. पहले ये अगेन बहुत सारे डिसाइडेड केसेस हैं, आप चाहें तो नाम भी लिख सकते हैं. एक नटराज ऑर्गेनिक्स का अलाहाबाद हाईकोर्ट का डिसीजन है, उसके अलावा एक टेलको रिक्रिएशन क्लब करके एक बड़ा ही इंटरेस्टिंग टिस्को रिक्रिएशन क्लब करके एक सुप्रीम कोर्ट का बड़ा इंटरेस्टिंग डिसीजन है. उसके अंदर क्वेश्चन किस तरीके के थे, लेट मी पुट दोस क्वेश्चंस बिफोर यू. सरकार कहती है फर्टिलाइजर मैन्युफैक्चरर को दैट यू सप्लाई योर फर्टिलाइजर फॉर 800 रुपीस पर बैग. तो सप्लायर कहता है कि जी 800 रुपए तो मेरी कॉस्ट भी नहीं है. तो दे से डोंट वरी, वी हैव अ बॉडी कॉल्ड इफको, हम उसको बोलेंगे, वो आपको 150 रुपए एज सब्सिडी दे देगा. तो एक अरेंजमेंट बन जाता है. बायर जब आता है उसके पास तो वो 800 रुपए में बेच देता है उसको मैन्युफैक्चरर. उसके बाद महीने के एंड में एक पर्ची बनाता है कि जी मैंने 1000 बैग बेचे, आप मेरे को 150 × 1000 1.5 लाख रुपए भेज दो. वो इफको उसे दे देती है. तो क्वेश्चन ये कई बार अराइज हुआ कि कैन इट बी कंसिडर्ड टू बी कंसिडरेशन फॉर सेल. सो द कोर्ट्स आंसर्ड इट ब्यूटिफुली. दे सेड दैट कंसिडरेशन फॉर सेल मीन्स something which is receivable in the bargain between the parties. In this case, the bargain was between the seller, namely the manufacturer, and the buyer, let us say the farmer. So they said, assuming that IFCO tomorrow doesn't pay 150 rupees per bag to the manufacturer, can the manufacturer recover it from the buyer? If the answer is no, they said this cannot be considered as consideration for the supplier. So therefore, now they have specifically included the subsidies which are directly linked to the price. So even if that is not the price payable by the recipient, then also it is included for the purpose of payment of GST. मैं आगे चलता हूँ. लेकिन अगर वो सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट या स्टेट गवर्नमेंट देती है तो नहीं इंक्लूड होगा. नाउ लेट मी गो टू 3. ये कुछ स्पेसिफिक एक्सक्लूजन्स हैं. द वैल्यू ऑफ सप्लाई शैल नॉट इंक्लूड एनी डिस्काउंट विच इज गिवन बिफोर और एट द टाइम ऑफ सप्लाई. तो जो डिस्काउंट सप्लाई से ही पहले दे दिया या टाइम ऑफ सप्लाई पे दे दिया, इफ इट इज रिकॉर्डेड ऑन द इनवॉइस तो देन दैट्स फाइन. If it is a discount which is given after the supply has been effected, then they say it can still be deducted if such discount is established in terms of an agreement entered into at or before the time of such supply and specifically linked to relevant invoices. And the input tax credit attributable to discount on the basis of document issued by supplier has been reversed by the recipient of the supply. तो मैं एक बात कहना चाहता हूं इसके ऊपर. हम कई बार बहुत सारा डिस्कशन करते हैं, कई बार देर आर मेनी सिचुएशंस विच वी आर सीकिंग द आंसर, बट इन इट्स सिंपलेस्ट सेंस व्हाट दिस 3 मींस इज दैट अ डिस्काउंट बाय व्हाटएवर नेम कॉल्ड, यू मे कॉल इट एन अर्ली पेमेंट डिस्काउंट, यू मे कॉल इट अ कैश डिस्काउंट, यू मे कॉल इट अ क्वांटिटी डिस्काउंट, यू मे कॉल इट अ ट्रेड डिस्काउंट, यू मे कॉल इट अ कोरोना डिस्काउंट, यू मे कॉल इट अ कैलामिटी डिस्काउंट, यू मे कॉल इट अ क्लियरेंस डिस्काउंट, यू मे कॉल इट कि आपकी शक्ल मुझे अच्छी लगी डिस्काउंट, यू मे कॉल इट कि यू केम एज द फर्स्ट कस्टमर डिस्काउंट. आप कोई भी नाम ले लीजिए, उसके लिए नाम इज नॉट रेलिवेंट. देर आर ओनली 2 थिंग्स टू बी सीन. नंबर 1, द द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन विच इज टू बी आस्क्ड इज कि क्या आपने इनवॉइस के ऊपर डिस्काउंट दे दिया, फिर तो बात ही खत्म हो गई, फिर तो आपको किसी से कुछ पूछना ही नहीं है कि वो किस चीज का डिस्काउंट है, आप जो मर्जी नाम दे दो उसको। सेकेंड, अगर ऐसा नहीं है तो द सेकेंड क्वेश्चन इज, तो फिर आपको ये डिमॉन्स्ट्रेट करना पड़ेगा, अगर आपने इनवॉइस नहीं दी तो आपसे पूछा जाएगा कि क्या आपके पास कॉन्ट्रैक्ट सप्लाई के समय था डिस्काउंट देने का, अगर था तो आप उसको वैल्यू में से रिड्यूस कर सकते हैं। कई बार हमें ये भी डाउट हो जाता है कि वैल्यू में से रिड्यूस करने का क्या मतलब है, उसका मतलब यह कि हम जीएसटी पर्पस के लिए उसको माइनस कर सकते हैं। एक्चुअल में तो आपका, आपने अगर डिस्काउंट बाद में दिया और अग्रीमेंट पहले नहीं भी था तो भी आप उसे माइनस तो करेंगे ही। आप पार्टी को अगर आपने शुरू में 100 रुपए का बेचा बट उस दिन यू हैड नो अग्रीमेंट और गिविंग एनी डिस्काउंट, 3 महीने बाद वो आपको आके बोला कि जी आपका माल तो बिक ही नहीं रहा, तो आपने कहा अच्छा एक काम करो मैं आपको 10% डिस्काउंट दे दूंगा आप बेच दो। इन दैट केस इवन दो यू डू नॉट फॉल विद इन द प्रोविजन, आप उसको तो 10 रुपए का नोट दोगे ही, बट आप उस अमाउंट को जीएसटी पर्पज के लिए माइनस नहीं कर सकते, दैट इज वॉट दैट वुड मीन। सो दिस इज अ प्रोविजन विच इज क्वाइट सिंपल, उसके ऊपर काफी सर्कुलर्स ने ये कंफ्यूजन वगैरह कर दिया, उसके बाद एक सर्कुलर इशू हो गया वो रिवर्स भी हो गया, तो आई थिंक द सर्कुलर विच स्टैंड्स इज ऑलमोस्ट ऑन द राइट करेक्ट फुटिंग, मोटा मोटा वो ठीक है सर्कुलर जो एक इशू है ऑलरेडी विच इज देयर इन प्लेस। उसके बाद एक अब क्वेश्चन एक ये अराइज होता है कि अगर कोई केस हमारा ऐसा है विच के नॉट फॉल अंडर 15(1), 15(1) में कौन से केसेस फॉल नहीं कर सकते? नंबर वन, वो केस जहां पर प्राइस है बट वो रिलेटेड पार्टीज के बीच में है। दूसरा, प्राइस है बट वो सोल कंसिडरेशन नहीं है, जैसे हमने एक मोबाइल का एग्जांपल दिया था, उसने 5,000 का मोबाइल खरीदा पर साथ में 5,000 के साथ में पुराना मोबाइल भी दे दिया, अब वो किसी को नहीं पता कितने का था, कोई उसकी बातचीत भी नहीं हुई, उसने पुराना मोबाइल दिखाया, नए वाले ने उसको 5,000 में दे दिया विद द मोबाइल, तो वो उस तरह का केस। तीसरा, आप सबको मालूम है कि बहुत से ऐसे केसेस भी हैं जीएसटी में वेयर इवन इफ द ट्रांजैक्शन इज विदाउट कंसिडरेशन देयर इज अ लायबिलिटी टू पे टैक्स, जिसको हम बोलते हैं शेड्यूल 1 की ट्रांजैक्शंस, शेड्यूल 1 टू द सीजीएसटी एक्ट, उस केस के अंदर भी आप 15(1) में वैल्यूएशन नहीं कर सकते। देयरफॉर इन दोज केसेस सेक्शन 15(4) अप्लाइज एंड दे से वेयर द वैल्यू ऑफ द सप्लाई ऑफ गुड्स और सर्विसेज और बोथ cannot be determined under subsection 1, the same shall be determined in such manner as may be prescribed. अब मैं एक चीज जरूर डिस्कस करना चाहता हूं इस केस में। सबसे पहले तो 4 लगेगा कब? जहां पर it cannot be determined under 1. तो 4 में और कोई केस नहीं है। अगर कोई केस में 1 में फॉल कर रहा है तो वो 4 में फॉल नहीं कर सकता, दैट इज नंबर 1। नंबर 2, इन दैट केस इट शैल बी डिटर्मिंड इन सच मैनर एज मे बी प्रिस्क्राइब्ड। और प्रेस्क्राइब्ड की मैं चाहता हूं आप लोग सब एक चीज जरूर देखें, प्रेस्क्राइब्ड इज नॉट समथिंग विच इज आउट ऑफ लॉ, इट इज समथिंग विच इज डिफाइंड। लेट अस सी दैट। इफ यू सी सेक्शन 287, यू वुड फाइंड दैट सेक्शन 287 डिफाइंस प्रेस्क्राइब्ड एज प्रेस्क्राइब्ड बाय रूल्स मेड अंडर दिस एक्ट ऑन द रिकमेंडेशंस ऑफ द काउंसिल। तो यानी सिर्फ रूल्स को ही बाय वे ऑफ प्रेस्क्रिप्शन कहते हैं, तो जो रूल बनते हैं वो आपको फॉलो करने हैं अगर आपका केस 15 में फॉल नहीं करता। मैंने स्पेशली आपको डेफिनेशन इसलिए दिखाई कि ये हमारे लिए अभी आगे रेलेवेंट होने वाली है। नाउ काइंडली सी 15(5), मैं ये रूल्स के ऊपर आऊंगा ब्रीफली, हम लोग थोड़ा सा डिस्कस करेंगे, बट बिफोर दैट लेट्स डिस्कस 15(5). नॉट विथस्टैंडिंग एनीथिंग कंटेन्ड इन सबसेक्शन 1 और सबसेक्शन 4, यानी दिस इज एन ओवरराइडिंग प्रोविजन। Even if you fall under 1, even if you fall under 4, still 15(5) can apply. That is number 1. Now let us see what 15(5) says. The value of such supplies as may be notified by the government on the recommendation of the council shall be determined in such manner as may be prescribed. तो आप एक चीज देखिए, इसमें एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट चीज है जो लीगल साइड से जो लोग हैं वो जरूर इसको अप्रिशिएट भी करेंगे और दे विल फाइंड इट टू बी वेरी यूजफुल ऑल्सो। सेक्शन 15(5) जो है वो एक कंडीशन है कि अगर चाहे 1 में और 4 में भी फॉल करता है तो भी वो 15(5) में फॉल कर सकता है, बट उसके लिए एक प्रोसेस दिया गया है। वो प्रोसेस को एक बार दोबारा देखते हैं कि वो क्या कहता है। द वैल्यू ऑफ सच सप्लाईज एज मे बी नोटिफाइड बाय द गवर्नमेंट, ऑन द रिकमेंडेशन ऑफ द काउंसिल. कहने का मतलब कि सबसे पहली रिक्वायरमेंट ये है 15(5) की एप्लीकेशन की कि वो कुछ पर्टिकुलर सप्लाईज को गवर्नमेंट नोटिफाई करेगी. सो द फर्स्ट रिक्वायरमेंट इज टू नोटिफाई द सप्लाई. लेट अस से उन्होंने बोला कि बिल्डर की सर्विसेज को हम नोटिफाई करते हैं, उन्होंने बोला कि केटरर की सर्विसेज को हम नोटिफाई करते हैं, ऑल राइट. बट देन व्हाट हैपेंस, उसके बाद ये प्रोविजन बोलता है शैल बी डिटरमिन्ड इन सच मैनर एज मे बी प्रिस्क्राइब्ड. तो यानी एक बारी जब उन्होंने सप्लाई को नोटिफाई कर दिया, आफ्टर दैट इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ दोस सप्लाईज व्हाट वुड हैपन, द वैल्यूएशन वुड बी डिटरमिन्ड इन सच मैनर एज मे बी प्रिस्क्राइब्ड. प्रिस्क्राइब्ड का डेफिनेशन मैंने अभी आपको दिखाया था, वो था कि वो रूल्स में जाना पड़ेगा. तो ये 15(5) जो है वो एक्चुअली एक टू स्टेज्ड प्रोसेस, आई एम कॉलिंग इट अ टू डबल स्टेज्ड प्रोसेस. नंबर वन, द गवर्नमेंट इन ऑर्डर टू फॉल विद इन 15(5) द गवर्नमेंट हैज टू इश्यू अ नोटिफिकेशन. इन द नोटिफिकेशन दे हैव टू नोटिफाई सर्टेन सप्लाईज दैट वी वॉन्ट टू मेक इट कवर्ड अंडर 15(5). Once they notify the supply, thereafter they have to make a rule and say that we are telling this rule would apply in respect of these supplies. मैं आपको एक एग्जाम्पल देता हूं. आप एक डिसीजन देखेंगे हिंदुस्तान जिंक का, ट्राइब्यूनल का डिसीजन था. इन दैट केस वॉट हैपेंड वॉज, आप सब जो सर्विस टैक्स के जमाने से प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं, यू वुड रिकॉल कि लायबिलिटी टू पे सर्विस टैक्स वॉज ऑन द सप्लायर ऑफ सर्विसेज. वहां पे उसको सर्विस प्रोवाइडर बोलते थे. सर्विस प्रोवाइडर जब लायबल था तो सेक्शन 68 के अंदर इसी तरीके का एक प्रोविजन था, उसमें उन्होंने बोला कि सरकार नोटिफिकेशन निकाल के कुछ सर्विसेज के ऊपर ऐसा बता सकती है कि समवन एल्स हैज टू पे द टैक्स. सो अगेन देयर वाज अ टू स्टेज्ड प्रोसेस वेयर गवर्नमेंट हैड टू फर्स्ट नोटिफाई द सर्विसेज फॉर विच इट वॉन्ट टू अप्लाई 68 टू, एंड देन had to provide a rule that who shall be paying the tax in those cases. Tab hua kya ki unhone ek rule banaya, rule 21D of the service tax rules. Rule 21D ke andar unhone bola ki recipient ko tax dena hai agar koi bahar ki services hai aur recipient India ka hai. Par hua kya, wo notification nikalna bhul gaye ki we want to tax such like services under 68(2). और वो नोटिफिकेशन वो पहली बार, इफ आई एम नॉट रॉन्ग, वो पहली बार 2006 में लेके आए. तब ट्राइब्यूनल ने ये होल्ड किया कि देयर वुड बी नो टैक्स चार्जेबल अंडर 68(2) इन द हैंड्स ऑफ द रिसिपिएंट इवन इफ देयर इज अ रूल प्रोवाइडिंग फॉर दैट बिकॉज देयर इज नो नोटिफिकेशन अप टू दैट डेट. तो यहां पर भी 15(5) में भी ये इशू है कि अनलेस द सप्लाईज आर फर्स्ट नोटिफाइड एंड द मैकेनिज्म इज प्रोवाइडेड इन द रूल, 15(5) इज नॉट कंप्लीट. अब मैं आपको इसके ऊपर एक दो एग्जांपल्स देता हूं जो प्रैक्टिकल एग्जांपल्स हैं. 15(5) के लिए इन्होंने, अगर आप रेट की नोटिफिकेशन पढ़ेंगे 1/2017 एंड ऑल, यू वुड फाइंड कि उसमें इन्होंने 15(5) को भी ले लिया है. रेट की नोटिफिकेशन में दे से 15(5) इज दे हैव आल्सो रेफर्ड टू 15(5). Now the question arises, जैसे एक एग्जाम्पल लेते हैं, एक बिल्डर का केस है. बिल्डर के केस में इन्होंने क्या किया, इन्होंने बोला कि हम 1/3 को लैंड मान लेंगे और नोटिफिकेशन में ये कह दिया. तो अगर कोई बिल्डर एक फ्लैट बेचता है, अगर उसने 1,20,00,000 रुपए का एक फ्लैट बेचा और लैंड के ऊपर टैक्स नहीं लगता, सिर्फ कंस्ट्रक्शन पार्ट के ऊपर टैक्स लगता है, तो लॉ ने बाय नोटिफिकेशन ये कह दिया कि हम 15(5) को अप्लाई कर रहे हैं और उसके अंदर उन्होंने कह दिया कि हम 1/3 की वैल्यू को लैंड मान रहे हैं. मैं अभी इस एस्पेक्ट को और इसमें और इश्यूज भी डिस्कशन किया वो करूंगा, बट इसको अभी हम सिर्फ इस एग्जांपल को एग्जामिन कर रहे हैं 15(5) के पर्सपेक्टिव से. तो उन्होंने क्या बोला कि 15(5) को यूज करके 2/3 ऑफ द सेल प्राइस ऑफ द फ्लैट को उन्होंने कंस्ट्रक्शन की वैल्यू मान लिया. नाउ द क्वेश्चन इज, क्या नोटिफिकेशन के थ्रू वो ये वैल्यू मान सकते हैं? The answer, according to me, is that they should have first notified the service of a builder. And assuming कि उन्होंने 1/2017 में उसको notification या जो भी notification है services की उसके अंदर उसको मान भी लिया कि ये this is the value on this is the notification under 15.5 and this has covered the builder's activity. But then the point is that two-third वाला जो mechanism है that should have been given by way of rules. That cannot be given in the notification. और अब आप लोग कुछ लोग आप लोगों के दिमाग में कुछों के ये क्वेश्चन जरूर आ रहा होगा कि व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस इन प्रोवाइडिंग द मैकेनिज्म इन द नोटिफिकेशन और इन द रूल. द आंसर लाइज नॉट इन द फॉर्म बट इन द प्रेस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ द लॉ. अकॉर्डिंग टू मी द लॉ इज दैट इफ समथिंग इज स्टेटेड टू बी डन इन अ पर्टिकुलर वे देन इट हैज टू बी डन ओनली इन दैट वे एंड इन नो अदर वे. तो अगर सरकार ने डेलीगेशन करी है पावर की और उन्होंने क्लियरली एक प्रोसेस बताया है दैट यू हैव टू नोटिफाई अ सर्विस टू बी कवर्ड अंडर 15.5 एंड वंस यू कवर इट अंडर 15.5 यू हैव टू इशू बाय वे ऑफ अ नोटिफिकेशन बाय वे ऑफ रूल्स यू हैव टू गिव दैट स्पेशल मेथड ऑफ वैल्यूएशन देन द गवर्नमेंट कैन नॉट से नो नो वी विल नॉट इशू द वैल्यूएशन बाय वे ऑफ रूल्स वी विल स्टिल डू इट बाय वे ऑफ अ नोटिफिकेशन. For the rule, the law is binding on all, including the state. अगर आप पटना हाईकोर्ट का लार्सन एंड टूब्रो का डिसीजन देखेंगे और एक झारखंड हाईकोर्ट का डिसीजन है पटना हाईकोर्ट का उड़ीसा हाईकोर्ट का both these and they have both been cited by Justice Nariman in Larsen and Toubro's decision 2016 service tax. It is 2016 volume 13 SCC. उसके अंदर उन्होंने बोला कि जो लॉ मेकर है जो डेलीगेट ही है वो ये नहीं कह सकता कि मेरे को लॉ बनाने के लिए कहा गया लेकिन मैं नहीं बना रहा या मैं वैसे नहीं बना रहा पर मैं मान लूंगा कि मैंने इसको फॉलो कर लिया है. दे सेड दिस वेरी क्लियरली. सो देयरफॉर अकॉर्डिंग टू मी द प्रेस्क्रिप्शन इन द नोटिफिकेशन दैट वी शैल बी वैल्यूइंग बिल्डर्स ऑन 2/3 ऑफ द वैल्यू ऑफ द सेल ऑफ फ्लैट इज नॉट इन लाइन विद द प्रोविजंस ऑफ सेक्शन 15.5. दिस इज वन थिंग which we can use at an appropriate time if this two-third is creating a problem to us. Now, likewise, development rights ke case mein bhi, you would find that they have in the notification itself stated that development rights agar aap valuation ke liye डेवलपमेंट राइट्स की टैक्सेबिलिटी अगर अराइज होती है तो उसकी वैल्यूएशन वुड बी इक्वल टू द वैल्यू ऑफ फ्लैट्स. दैट अगेन इज कमिंग बाय वे ऑफ अ नोटिफिकेशन. सो इन दोस केसेस वेयर वन कैन आर्ग्यू दैट डेवलपमेंट राइट्स की वैल्यू फ्लैट की वैल्यू तो हो ही नहीं सकती, उसने जितना कंस्ट्रक्शन मेरे लिए किया सिर्फ उतनी वैल्यू हो सकती है बिकॉज मैंने उसको उसका लैंड दिया, उसने मेरे को मेरा कंस्ट्रक्शन दिया. इसको भी वी विल इलेबोरेट इट स्लाइटली मोर, वी विल डिस्कस इट. But what I want to make a point here is that in that case also, valuation by notification itself may not be sustainable. Ye ek issue I wanted to put it across. Now, let us go to the rules and very briefly discuss what the rules say. And then I will take certain specific situations, specific problems, though I have discussed many of the aspects by referring to the case laws and many of your examples would have already been covered in these different examples that I took. But I will also be taking certain 10-11 specific kind of situations relating to valuation and what would really be the answer to those according to me. Before that, let us see the rules very, very briefly. Rule 27 is the rule where the valuation starts. One thing I want to say that related persons they have defined in explanation, but the interesting thing is I don't want to go into the definition of relationships that you can all read and understand. There's nothing very specific about it, but what I want to say is this explanation before section 15 says for the purposes of this act persons shall be deemed to be related if. So what I want to submit and state here is that this is a very poor drafting device, that rather than putting definitions under section 2, you are putting definitions for the whole of the act below section 15. A normal person who is required to study these four different laws together You all know IGST, CGST, UTGST, then all the states, SGSTs, and then the Compensation Act, which makes it to around 34, 35 laws. How can we expect a commoner to understand this and then also to find out that the definition of related persons for entire act is provided for in explanation below section 15? This is a very, very poor drafting device. They should have put it in section 2 itself. I don't know why they have included it here. Then the term person, they say, includes legal person. I don't know. Despite defining the person in the act, what was the specific need for, again saying, for the purposes of this act, person would also include this. These are quite, for me, these are quite strange things which they have done, because section 2, subsection 84 already defines a person, and it already includes a company, it includes a LLP, it includes association of person, etc., corporation, etc. So all these things already includes a legal person. I don't know why they say that person also includes a legal person. There was no need to say this. Then they say person who are associated in the business of one another in that one is the sole agent or sole distributor. So this is again an extension of the meaning which they want to give, shall be deemed to be related. So this is again for related person. So now moving on to the rules. This is chapter 4, starts from rule 27. The first thing which they say is value of supply of goods or services where the consideration is not wholly in money. So the first case which we discussed while discussing 15.1, that if a person has given his mobile phone, then what happens? Let us see what is the answer. They say where the supply of goods or services is for a consideration not wholly in money, the value of supply shall be the open market value of such supply. So the example which I gave of the mobile phone, which was given at 5,000 plus old mobile, will be determined by the value of the new mobile phone. And what is open market value? Again, they have created this blunder. Rather than defining in rule 2 of the rules, they have given this definition below the last rule. Please see this. There is an explanation below the last rule which says that open market value means the full value of money excluding the integrated tax, etc., where the supplier and recipient are not related and the price is the sole consideration. So assuming that in that case the shopkeeper generally sells the mobile phone at 8,000 rupees, then that would be the value of that mobile phone. But agar wo open market value available hi nahi hai, jaise mobile phone jaise case mein to aapko open market value mil jayegi, but kuch aise cases hote hain jahan pe un cheezon ki open market value ekdam se nahi nikali ja sakti. Jaise main agar aapko example du, kuch aisi koi work of art hai, a work of art which is made by a painter whose paintings are themselves distinguishable. In that case, what will happen? How will you determine the open market value? There, what happens is they say that don't go by the open market value of the supply. Jaise main aapko ek example isi case mein de deta hu. Agar ye mobile phone ki bajaye, let us say koi particular variety ka horse hota, that the supplier has supplied horse in consideration of 5 lakh rupees plus, let us say, plus 100 bags of wheat. तो जो supplier है उसने horse दिया, जो buyer है उसने 5 lakh rupees दिए plus 100 bags of wheat दिए. In that case, open market value, assuming उस घोड़े की, ये कोई बड़ा special type का घोड़ा है जिसकी open market value available नहीं है, या कोई इस case में आप painting ले सकते हैं जिसकी कोई open market value इतनी clearly available नहीं है. In those cases, you will go to clause B. यहाँ पर वो बोलता है, if the open market value is not available under clause A, be the sum total of consideration in money and any such further amount in money as is equivalent to the consideration not in money, if such amount is known at the time of supply. तो अब जो आपके केस में 5 लाख रुपए घोड़े के लिए आपने दिए plus 100 bags of wheat दिए, उसको value करना is very simple. तो आप उसको add करिए और वो आपकी consideration निकल जाए. That is very very easy. तो अब let me take the another example. अगर आप डेवलपमेंट राइट्स को वैल्यू करेंगे तो इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू डिटरमिन द ओपन मार्केट वैल्यू ऑफ डेवलपमेंट राइट्स, बट इट इज वेरी इजी टू फाइंड आउट द वैल्यू ऑफ फ्लैट्स व्हिच यू आर गेटिंग इन कंसिडरेशन फॉर द डेवलपमेंट राइट्स. तो प्रैक्टिकली इन केस ऑफ थिंग्स लाइक लैंड, इन केस ऑफ थिंग्स लाइक डेवलपमेंट राइट्स, यू मोर इन मोर केसेस यू डोंट फॉल अंडर 27A, बट जनरली यू वुड टेंड टू फॉल अंडर 27B, वेयर एवर द कंसिडरेशन इज इन नॉन मॉनिटरी टर्म्स. तो ये दीज कैन बी सम एग्जांपल। और अगर आप यहां भी नहीं डिटरमिन कर पाते तो फिर वो बोलता है लाइक काइंड एंड क्वालिटी के लिए कर लीजिए, या फिर आप आगे 30-31 में चले जाइए। आई एम नॉट गेटिंग इन टू दीज निसिटीज एंड ये सब आपको मालूम है, आई जस्ट वॉन्टेड टू टेक दीज एग्जाम्पल्स टू ब्रिंग होम दीज पॉइंट। नाउ इफ यू सी value of supply of goods or services both between distinct or related person other than through an agent, again they want to take the open market value, and if the open market value is not available then goods of like kind and quality. aap sabko malum hai ki agar koi supplier apne agent ko goods deta hai ki agent use aage bech le ya aage usko agent supply kar de, to in those cases jo supplier एजेंट को माल भेजता है विच इज नॉट एक्चुअली अ सेल हैज बीन ट्रीटेड टू बी अ सप्लाई विदाउट कंसिडरेशन, इन दोस केसेस उसको वैल्यू करने के लिए दे हैव गिवन रूल 28। देन 29, आई एम नॉट गेटिंग नाउ टू मच इनटू दिस एजेंट एंड ऑल, यू ऑल नो दिस, बट मैं आपको इससे पहले जो डिस्कस करना चाहता हूँ वो सीधे हम चलते हैं। अगर ये सब नहीं हो पाता तो कॉस्ट बेसिस पे इज रूल 30 एंड 31 इज रेजिडुअल मेथड, कि आप आपका प्रिंसिपल जो है दैट इज ट्रांजैक्शन वैल्यू का प्रिंसिपल, अप्लाई दैट प्रिंसिपल एंड फाइंड आउट द नियरेस्ट वैल्यू। सो उन्होंने कोई चीज चांस पे नहीं छोड़ी, कल को यू कैन आर्ग्यू दैट देयर इज नो मेथड ऑफ वैल्यूएशन देयरफॉर देयर कैन बी नो टैक्स, सो दे से देयर वी हैव गिवन अ रेसिडुअल मेथड, इफ द वैल्यू इज नॉट डिटरमिनेबल इन एनी वे देन प्लीज फाइंड आउट द वैल्यू बाय अप्लाइंग द प्रिंसिपल्स दैट वी हैव गिवन टू यू, प्लीज अप्लाई सम बेसिस to find out the nearest value. और उसके लिए accountants are the best people, those who deal in valuations are the best people, they know different ways, different means, different manner in which values can be derived. तो वो जैसे किसी ने अगर कोई सामान बेचा और वो उसकी वैल्यू भी अवेलेबल नहीं है, और वो जिसके बदले में बेचा उसकी वैल्यू भी ओपन मार्केट में अवेलेबल नहीं है, ना उसके सिमिलर आइटम्स कोई मिलते, तो यू प्लीज फाइंड आउट way in which it can be best value. But us case mein bhi kai baar problems aa sakte hain, main jab practical cases 5-7 discuss karunga at that time I will highlight ki kis tarah ke problems us case mein bhi aa sakte hain, aur us case mein shayad koi method available hi nahi hai. Lottery, betting, gambling and all these are all I am not discussing. Then determination of value, these are all specific provisions relating to money changers, all those supplier of airline tickets and all, then there are old goods वगैरह के लिए respect में है। मैं इसके अंदर देखिए मैं आपको दिखाना चाह रहा था वो एक तो केरला वाले फ्लड सेस के रेस्पेक्ट में 32A में उन्होंने क्लियरली एक्सक्लूड कर दिया आपका, ये वाला जो केरला फाइनेंस बिल के अंदर लगता है शैल बी एक्सक्लूडेड बट शैल नॉट इंक्लूड द सेस, तो वो उन्होंने एक्सक्लूड कर दिया। उसके अलावा वैल्यू ऑफ सप्लाई ऑफ सर्विसेज इन केस ऑफ प्योर एजेंट, उन्होंने बोला notwithstanding anything contained in the provisions of this chapter, the expenditure or cost incurred by a supplier as a pure agent of the recipient shall be excluded from the value of supply if all the following conditions are satisfied. तो basically उन्होंने आपको ये बोल दिया कि अगर आप जैसे अगर आप as a pure agent act करते हैं तो वो जो expenses आप कर रहे हैं that will be excluded. Let me take one example because I wanted to discuss this. Let us take two examples. Let us say we have started accountant. The easiest is are incorporating a company. They have also given this illustration, but only to bring home the point. We are incorporating a company and charging 10,000 rupees for incorporation or 1 lakh rupees for incorporation. And along with that, we also in our bill say we paid 1,000 rupees for getting the name search done, and also for ROC fees we pay 5,000 rupees as ROC fee. So we charge a bill of 1 lakh plus 1,000 for name search, 10,000 for ROC fee, and we send a bill of 1,11,000. In that case, since the ROC fees was actually payable by the company, therefore you become simply a pure agent of those for whom you are doing this work, and in those cases this shall remain excluded. However, in cases where you are not acting as a pure agent, let me take an example. If a person has to do certain work, let us say there is an engineer and he has to take care of the site of the client, he has to go there, he has to check whether the road is being correctly made, are the guidelines of PWD being followed, he has to guide the labor, and there are architects, all those, they are all working there on the site. In that case what would happen, that he charges 5 lakh rupees for his service And over and above, under the agreement, it is stated that he is also entitled to his traveling. He is also entitled to his cost and expenditure that he incur for going to the site, for living there, because he has to go to remote locations. So all those boarding, lodging, then he is also allowed 10% addition to 5 lakh rupees as his office administrative expenses. He is also allowed 5% for his photocopy expenses. All these, he, apart from 5 lakh, he bill all these amounts to the client. In all these cases, while he is incurring the expenditure, while he is going to that place, while he is living at that place, all these expenditure he is not incurring as a pure agent. He is incurring all those in his own capacity. He is incurring his office expenses in his own capacity. He is getting it paid over and above the amount that he was to get as the basic fee. So we can say it is a basic fee and there is an additional amount that he can charge under the contract. So that amount will not fall within the meaning of pure agent and would not fall within the exclusion and therefore would be included in the value. Now let me go to the specific, the last, I think I want to discuss the last one more rule. Yeah. If you see 35, it allows you where the value of supply is inclusive of integrated tax, or as the case may be, central tax, state tax, duty tax, the tax amount shall be determined in the following manner. So if the amount is already included, then they have also given a formula. So what happens is, many a cases you just have a retail sale price, there is a buyer, he doesn't want to separately show the tax, etc. You simply write MRP and charge, or you simply write 30 rupees and charge that amount from him. In all those cases, the legislature itself, the rules itself grant you the formula that you can reverse calculate the GST by applying this formula. Now, having discussed the statutory provision with help of some examples, now allow me to kindly move to some of the specific aspects. The first aspect which I want to discuss it is a bit contentious. It is TCS. They have issued a circular and they have stated that TCS would have to be included in the value. We all know that TCS is nothing but tax collected over and above the supply price from the supplier, by the supplier from the recipient. So if a liquor manufacturer supplies liquor worth rupees 5 lakhs to the distributor, over and above 5 lakh, he also collects an amount as TCS, which he simply directly pays to the government. That amount does not come to him, does not belong to him. It is an amount which he collects under a statutory mandate on behalf of the government and deposits it to the government. And when he deposits it, it is considered to be an amount which is paid on behalf of the buyer as the buyer's income tax. Now they have issued a circular saying that this TCS would be included in the value. Now I don't know. Today the situation is that first of all they issue a circular and then they withdraw it, modify it. Today we are all keeping track of the circulars like law, that which circular has been withdrawn, which has been superseded, which has been amended. I'm not really aware whether this circular number 76/50 has been superseded by any further circular, not to my knowledge. But
yes, in sir, that
if any participant has any information that they have superseded this circular, then
Puneet, you
may bring it to our knowledge and attention. Rahul bhai may also inform
me. They have issued a corrigendum.
But on this circular, they have not amended. I don't think this is the correct position in law, because the bargain between the parties is only for 5 lakh rupees. The amount which is over and above that is only a statutory liability, and the nature of it is does not form partake the nature of the sale price or the price which the supplier charges for the liquor. The agreement itself says that 5 lakh rupees is the only amount which he has to, and TCS is a part of the statutory obligation. So that is one thing which I wanted to bring to the attention.
Another thing is
passenger service fees. This is an interesting example, and they have taken a correct view in this case. What happens is that the airports, for providing services to the passengers, they charge a certain sum as user development fee, as passenger service. But since the airports do not have direct linkage with the passenger, what they do is they say the airlines should collect this sum. And they also pay 5 rupees or some amount per passenger to the airline as collection charges. What the airline does is, if this is 250 rupees per UDF or PSF, airline add it in their fare, they show it separately, and as it is, they pay it to the airline, to the airport authorities. In that case, the circular has taken a stand that this would not be included in the value of the airline, and already the airports are paying tax on it, and they have stated that you should show it separately along with the tax element. So the airline fellow has to say, this is a ticket worth rupees 50,000 or 5,000. I am adding 250 rupees to it as passenger development fees, and on it already it includes GST of so and so sum, and then it can be excluded from the purview of tax liability in so far as the airline is concerned. Of course, it remains taxable in the hands of the airport. And these issues were there even under the service tax regime, which was successfully argued before the different courts, and these views were accepted even in those cases. Now, let me come to the issue relating to ITC being prohibited with the condition of rate of tax, say 5% on caterers or builders. I am discussing it along with this provision because they have created an integrated scheme. What they say is, for example, let me take the example of builders. They say, in case of builders, you will pay tax at 7.5%. Value shall be determined by applying 1/3 for the land. Balance would remain the value for construction. And after paying this tax, the condition is that you shall not be availing the ITC. So it is an integrated scheme which they formulated in the valuation notification, in the rate notification itself. They have integrated this scheme of completely prohibiting the ITC, of computing the value in a particular manner, and thereafter applying the rate of tax on that composite value and rate. Now, in this case, I want to submit that in cases where ITC is being denied or rather prohibited by way of a notification, according to me, this is wholly bad. This cannot be done. In the garb of applying these provisions in a consolidated manner, there is no provision under the Act which allows them to completely prohibit the availment of credit. So this, according to me, is illegal, and this they are doing in several cases, like they are doing this in the case of builders, they are doing it in the case of caterers, they are doing it in several, wherever they are reducing the rates of tax, they are saying that we will be doing it without the credit facility. But there is no provision. What they could have otherwise done was to issue separate rate notifications, exempting a portion of tax liability, giving an option to the supplier that you can go and opt for this facility of partial exemption without credit facility. Then it would have become valid. But such like cases, according to me, they are not valid. Apart from that, now coming to this very case of valuation, we discussed that they have reduced 1/3 as the value of land. So my first objection to this, as I explained, was on the basis of Section 15(5). You have already seen that. The second objection is now for the purpose for which, this is the purpose for which I specifically took you to the Section 9. Let me take you to Section 9 once again. It says that the maximum rate can be 25% on the value. Now let me give you one example. Let us say a flat was sold for 5 crore rupees. The construction part of that flat is only 50 lakh rupees. It's a case where it's a 5 crore rupees flat on a 200 square yard area, and the construction would in that case not more than 1500 square feet. If to construct 1500 square feet with best of the facilities would not take more than 50 lakh rupees. But since the value of land is so high in cities like Delhi, in cities like Bombay, that the flat can cost 5 crore, 6 crore, 7 crore, 8 crore, 9 crore, even on just a 200 square yard building. In that case, when we say that we shall be applying 1/3 deduction for land, and that would be the value of computation, by resorting to 15(5), then we are doing two breaches. One, we have not brought it by way of a notification, by way of rules. We have brought that method of valuation by way of the notification, number one. Number two, what we are also doing is a service which in fact is valued at 50 lakh rupees. And if we go by rule 30, 50 lakh plus 10%, because it says cost plus 10%, there you can say 55 lakh rupees. In that case, you are applying a rate which you are saying is only 5% or 7.5%. But in effect, when you apply this not to 50 lakh, but 5 crores, or let us take an example of 9 crore. 9 crore multiplied by 2/3 equal to 6 crore. 6 crore pe agar aap lagate hain 7.5% ka tax, so it is almost 45 lakh rupees, whereas the construction value was only 55 lakh rupees. Aur aapke paas maximum rate uske upar lagane ka 20% ka tha, aapne 20% ke bajaye uske upar 45 lakh rupees ka tax laga diya. 20 ko aur 20 kar dijiye, because CGST SGST mila ke 40% ka rate allowed hai. Aapne 45 lakh ka jab tax lagaya 55 lakh ki building pe, to aapne 90% ya 80% tax laga diya, which is beyond the purview, which is beyond the limit up to which you can impose the tax. So what you are doing is, in order to get out of this embargo of 40% rate of tax on value, you have adopted a subterfuge and you have included the value of land in the value of service, which was actually not allowed, and you are charging tax at a very, very high and exorbitant rate. This is another reason why this notification actually is not a valid piece of notification, and this should be quashed on all these grounds. There are several grounds which are available for quashing of this notification. Now, coming to the development rights, a very interesting position again in this. उन्होंने नोटिफिकेशन में ये कह दिया कि डेवलपमेंट राइट्स की जो वैल्यू होगी वो कंस्ट्रक्शन जितने भी यूनिट्स उस ओनर को मिल रहे हैं उसके बराबर होगी. सो लेट्स टेक एन एग्जांपल. लेट अस से दैट देयर वर 100 यूनिट्स व्हिच आर टू बी फॉर्मड इन अ हाउसिंग सोसाइटी और इन अ कमर्शियल कॉम्प्लेक्स 100 यूनिट्स आर टू बी मेड. आउट ऑफ दोज 100 यूनिट्स 40 आर टू कम टू द ओनर एंड 60 आर टू रिमेन विद द डेवलपर. नाउ देयर कैन बी डिफरेंट वेज ऑफ एंटरिंग इनटू द अग्रीमेंट. Number one, there can be a way where the owner says, I am giving development rights. In consideration of this, you give me 40 units, full 40 units. That is one way of saying. Second way can be, I am giving you development rights qua 60% of your area. You construct, in return, you do construction for me on the 40% area. The third case can be, we are not giving anything to each other. The owner says, I am having land. The contractor says, I will construct building on it with my own money, and that building remains my own building. We will then sell our respective things, namely you sell your land, I sell my building. Whatever money comes, we share it in a particular percentage. Your share is for land and my share is for building. There can be three different models. If we go under the first model, then the development right value would become equal to the 40 flats, which include the value of land also. That would be huge taxation. If we go by the second model, we can say that we gave development rights and in consideration, we are not getting flat, we are not getting unit, we are only getting construction activity from the builder. Then the value has to be equal to the construction activity. As per rule 27, that would be what is the normal value at which the construction can be done. So that reduces your liability substantially. So just you change the agreement, the liability can be changed. And if you go with the third model, which again we are following in various cases, there is no tax liability at all. So it depends upon the model that you follow, and you can have different tax liabilities in different models. So this is about development rights. Now let me take example of EDC, IDC. In our North India, we have amounts called external development charges and infrastructure development charges, which the local authorities charge from the builder, saying that since we have to develop these facilities, we charge it from you. Developer in turn charges that from the buyer. Under service tax regime, they had a circular saying EDC, IDC can be excluded from the value. But now, since all fee, all taxes, etc. are specifically included in the definition, therefore it would be very difficult to exclude such like charges even if the builder separately charges them from the buyer. One more case, and then we stop it, and then we take whatever questions are there. this issue of valuation arises with a great amount of problem in cases where, let us say, a company like Airtel, it has its brands in its brand owning company, and there are separate operation companies doing various activities under the brand name of Airtel. Or take a better example of Tata, which has a brand owning company owning the brand, and the operation all using brand Tata. And assume for a moment that there is no value put on the use of the brand name. Assuming we can take different examples. In that case, it is being without consideration, but between related parties, it becomes a transaction of Schedule 1 and hence liable to tax. Then the value is to be computed. Now, for brand name valuation, the biggest difficulty is how to find out comparables. In fact, by definition, brand name is something which distinguishes one brand from the other, products of one brand from the other. So to equate any other brand with one brand would be very, very not just difficult, but it is impractical and wrong to equate the value of one brand with the other brand. Therefore, the valuation of brand-like cases becomes very, very difficult under the present set of rules. And one may go to the extent of saying that in such a case, neither there are comparables nor any of the methods which are available in law can apply. So therefore, it may be a case to argue that the present scheme of things does not apply to such cases, though it would be very difficult because of the residual rule. But the difficulty comes because the residual rule also says that you go by the spirit of the previous rules and section 15, which is not available in case of brand name valuations. Another example which is there is in case of a foreign company giving a brand to its Indian subsidiaries, and actually there can be different ways of giving. One way can be to completely assign the brand to the Indian company and transfer it. In case of transfer, brands and copyrights having been held to be goods, therefore it would fall within the purview of import of goods. And in case of import of goods, you all know that section 5 subsection 1 proviso applies, and IGST Act has to give way to the application of Customs Act and the Custom Tariff Act. However, you all know that in such cases, in case of Customs Tariff Act and in Customs Act, the duty is imposed at the point at which the goods are appraised by an appraiser of the customs. However, for grant of brand, the goods never come through the customs brand barrier. It is just an agreement and the brand is given. Therefore, in such cases, again, the levy and imposition of Customs Act may be stated to have failed, and therefore no tax to be applicable at all under GST on such like transactions. And there is an authority also of Oracle Tribunal's case. It's a CSTAT decision where they have actually held that in such like cases, no customs duty can be imposed, even though there may be a levy under customs, but it is not collectible because the methods available under customs do not apply to such like transactions. There's one more case where intellectual properties, brands, trademarks, right to use, licenses, etc. have been granted by the foreign companies to their domestic subsidiaries, but they have been granted prior to the GST Act, and now nothing needs to be done. There are many what happened in such like cases that they have actually, they own the brands outside India, but they are actually used in India. They have become very successful in India, and years ago, 10 years, 12 years, 15 years, 20 years ago, they have actually licensed those brands to Indian companies. Indian companies are manufacturing goods, selling goods under those brand names, under those old license agreements. They have even been entered prior to the service tax regimes. Nothing needs to be done. There is no value to this. Everything is developed by the Indian branding, by the Indian company. All expenses incurred by the Indian company. In such like cases, the question arises whether a brand know-how license which has been granted years ago, can that be subjected to GST now by saying that it is a continuous use of the brand? There also it is a case to argue based upon the agreement between the parties that these like transactions would not be taxed because they have taken place, the transaction of licensing has taken place prior to the GST regime. This is an argument which again can be taken on the strength of several decisions which are there on the nature of these rights and the nature of agreements under the service tax regime and also under the sales tax regime. So this kind of a case can be dealt with by referring to these cases that amounts have been that the licenses have been granted prior to introduction of the GST regime, and that the GST regime has no retrospective applicability. So now this was the broad contours of the discussion. I would now request Bishan Bhai and Rahul Ji and the Honorable Chairman that whatever questions or whatever further discussion they want to do, they can just start that.
Yes, sir. So it was indeed a great presentation and deliberation on the subject. Now we are going to start. Oh, you can't hear me. Now can you hear me? Is it possible? Like audible now?
Yes.
Rahul bhai?
Yes, audible.
Rahul bhai?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you very much for your deliberation. And I'm glad to note that when idea is summarized, there is a tough issue I can say.
Yes, Bishan Bhai.
So now I can say you can hear me properly. Rahul Bhai?
Yes, perfect.
Perfect. Okay. So, sir, here I would like to say that you are now connected with so many people across the India, from Agra, from Indore, Mr. Naveen Khandelwal is there, from Delhi, Hukam Singh is there. From Mumbai, Prerna is there, and she posted so many questions also for you. And from Udaipur, Rashmi Mangu is there. From Kolkata, Arudas Gupta is there. Sir, when we thought to organize this webinar, there was an idea in the mind that we should prepare a note or summary note for the members so they can definitely hear it at there is, and that's the idea was accepted by our chairman, and I'm thankful to all the persons or young members of the branch that they come ahead, and also I acknowledge Naveen Khandelwal ji, who has from Indore regularly sending me the notes. Now sir, there are many questions. I can say 46 questions are there. So we will start it one by one. So
you will share the screen?
Yes, I am sharing the screen. Yes. So I have to hide myself first. Yes, sir. So now the first question. A little bit bigger. A company is into restaurant business and it also provides franchising. Where when it sells any restaurant which it had operated for more than 6 to 12 months, and then company sells that operational outlet as franchisee, which includes assets, stocks, and even charge franchisee fee too. So is it considered as a going concern sale? What will be the rate of GST? It will be chargeable, or it will be nil as per the serial number, because a slum sale, when you are selling your business with assets and all the liabilities, it is exempted. So but the company is in this type of regular business of selling their franchises. So your view and whether credit of capital assets will be available to it or not. Puneet sir.
The example itself says that when it sells any restaurant which it had operated for more than 6 to 12 months and then company sells that operational outlet as franchisee, which includes asset, stock and even charge franchise fee. Franchise fee to वैसे भी subsequently charge hogi for the grant of franchise, but the question would be I am assuming that franchise fee is separate from the sale of restaurant. So the sale of running restaurant, it would definitely be a slump sale. But the point is, I don't have notification in front of me. Assuming that the language of the notification is that sale of business as a going concern, then yes, it would fall within this exemption notification.
Yes, sir.
But the thing that is to be kept in mind is that the agreement should very clearly say it's an agreement for running restaurant on slump sale basis with assets, with manpower, which is running condition, and with as is where is basis, so that there is no ambiguity, there is no doubt on this aspect.
Sir, the next question is the place of supply of service in case of immovable property is the location of property. But if the property is financed by a finance company located at a different state than the property, does it have any effect on the place of supply when billing is made by a valuer directly to the finance company?
The question is not clear, but the place of supply would definitely not be affected by the situation of the financier. There is no doubt about it.
Bishan bhai, you are on mute. Bishan bhai, you are on mute. Mute, you are on mute.
Bishan bhai, aapki awaaz nahi aa rahi, aap kuch keh rahe the?
Sir, abhi sunai de raha hai.
The question is food.
Abhi sunai de
raha. Yes, yes.
So, food supply to employees in canteen at a subsidized rate, same food is supplied to contract labor. That is what they want. He wants to ask. So whether both are on open market value or not.
Food supplied to employees in canteen at a subsidized rate because they are related parties. That's why I think the question is because of that. In that yes. case, the subsidized price would not be the open market value.
A limited receive avail the service of renting of bus for transporting the employee. Service provider bill of the renting of bus with GST and other bill of RTO charges without GST. Whether RTO charges should be included in the renting bill?
Very good question. If the RTO charges are payable by the company, then they are not includable. If they are payable by the lessor, then they are includable. Ordinarily, it is the lessor's responsibility to get all those registrations done. Therefore, ordinarily, it should be included.
Hello.
This question I have already answered, whether TCS is part of valuation circular.
Sir,
yes, is,
I say yes, no. Sir. Yes. There is a corrigendum for of that circular, and as per that circular, they said that TCS is not required to add it to your valuation.
Yes,
and that's what I also thought there is something where where sanity prevailed on them, but I was not remembering the number of
yes, the corrigendum has been issued. Right.
So if you remember that number, you can just share it so for the benefit of all.
Or corrigendum 7650/2018, that is of 7th March 2019, and I'll be sharing it on the WhatsApp group, sir.
Right. Thank you. I have also noted. So they have taken the position which I discussed, right?
Yes. Sir, you are authority.
I was only
sir, aisa hoga to aap
high court
se le aaoge aur kya.
नहीं
Yes, Rahul.
A sale a product to B for 100 plus GST on credit, whereby A passes GST in his return. However, on later stage, B does not pay the consideration. Further, the transaction has led to the bad debt.
इसमें क्वेश्चन नहीं लिखा हुआ बट आई थिंक द वैल्यू रिमेंस टू बी 100 ओनली
या बट व्हाट ही वांट्स टू से सर कि इन रिटर्न ही हैज सोन इट एंड क्रेडिट भी पास ऑन हो गया बट फर्दर व्हाट हैपेंस कि दैट फेलो हैज नॉट पेड द कंसीडरेशन सो कैन आई रिवर्स इट और व्हाट दैट 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 शुड बी द क्लेरिफिकेशन
सो एक्चुअली द टैक्सेबल इवेंट अंडर जीएसटी इज सप्लाई It is not receipt of money. So merely because you don't receive money after supplying the goods, there would be no reversal. But if there is a mere agreement to supply, and for some reason the contract does not fructify into the contract into the actual supply, then it may be stated that there is no taxable event and therefore there is no supply. However, a confusion is created because Section 7(1)(a) says supply and agree to supply. That creates some kind of a confusion, but what I think is that it is only to cover the supplies and tax them even at the agreement stage. But if ultimately there is no supply, then one should be able to get the refund of the tax which has already stands paid, and Section 54 also gives an indication to this fact. But this is a clear cut case. Once supplied, then there is no resort.
Sir, what should be the taxable value of meal provided to employees during their working hours under GST law in the following cases? A, in case of subsidized meal, recovery from employees. In case where no amount is recovered from the employees and meal is provided free of cost. This is case of hotel and meal is cooked inside.
मेरे को ऐसा लगता है कि जो होटल के अंदर खाना जिस तरीके का बनता है, पहली बात तो अगर वो फ्री में मिल रहा है, तो ordinarily this should not be treated as a supply at all, because then this process will never end. हमारे ऑफिसेज में स्टाफ को चाय मिलती है, शाम को कुछ स्नैक्स मिलते हैं, तो वो सब फिर क्या, उसको बैठने के लिए जगह मिलती है, कंप्यूटर मिलता है, तो वो सप्लाई नहीं है. इट्स जस्ट अ कंडीशन ऑफ सर्विस. ही कम्स देयर, दीज आर फैसिलिटीज व्हिच आर मेड अवेलेबल टू हिम. इट इज नॉट अ सप्लाई. नो वन इंटेंड्स इट टू बी अ सप्लाई. फॉर सप्लायर एटलीस्ट देयर मस्ट बी अ सप्लायर एंड रिसिपिएंट. वो जो वहाँ चाय का रखा हुआ है, वो जो खाना रखा हुआ है, उसको हमेशा अपना ही समझता है. इट हैज नेवर कंसीडर्ड इट टू हैव बीन सप्लाइड बाय समवन एल्स. But having said so, अगर price आप recover करते हो, it is a clear cut case of supply where there is a recipient and a supplier. But in that case, मान लीजिए, let us take an example. उसको रोज के समय एक उन्होंने system बना रखा है, एक दिन राजमा के साथ सूखी सब्जी मिलती है, अगले दिन छोले के साथ सूखी सब्जी, something like that only it happens, no? So to go and find out the open market value may be very difficult in case of self-cooked food. So the best method would be to compute the cost and add 10% to it. And in all likelihood, जो जितना भी वो चार्ज कर रहे होंगे 20-25 रुपए, that will cover the cost plus 10%. This is what prima facie I feel.
So if you don't want to put yourself in litigation, then it's better to give this food to your employee at a free of cost and as a part of the service contract.
Hey, Bishan bhai, sometimes the commercial realities of it are such that you want to charge. In those cases, you will not change because there is some GST on it. Agar aapko paisa milta aur aapko lena hai, to aap loge us paise ko. Maybe in those cases, you will not be able to change.
A land developer is developing the agricultural land. During the development, therefore getting it converted into the NA, and other land development work such as land leveling, drainage, internal road, street light, etc. He gets the customer for buying the NA plot. Whether GST is to be paid and on what value it is to be paid.
मेरे हिसाब से इसमें GST payable नहीं है. Department का view इसमें clear है कि इसमें GST payable है. मैं इस पे High Court में हूँ, कुछ show cause notices में मेरे को stay भी मिले हुए हैं उनमें. मेरे हिसाब से it's a clear cut case of say agreement to sell land. और लैंड किस तरीके से मैं बेच रहा हूँ वो तो मेरी मर्जी है, मैं कैसे मर्जी बेचूं, बट द अग्रीमेंट इज फॉर सेल ऑफ लैंड. बट इसमें एक बात मैं जरूर कहूंगा कि रादर देन मेकिंग इट एन अग्रीमेंट फॉर सेल ऑफ लैंड एंड देन गेटिंग इनटू लिटिगेशन, द बेटर वे कैन बी दैट यू डिवाइड दिस एंटायर अग्रीमेंट इनटू लैंड एंड डेवलपमेंट ऑफ लैंड. उसका फायदा आपको ये होगा कि डेवलपमेंट पे आप टैक्स चार्ज करो, बायर से चार्ज कर लो, और पीछे आपको क्रेडिट भी मिल जाएगा, रिस्क भी आपका खत्म हो जाएगा. So that can be a better way of managing this transaction rather than because it has become litigated.
Yes. So please throw a light on difference between principles laid down by McDougall's case and L&T case of Honorable Supreme Court.
L&T ke naam se actually cases bahut sare hain. I don't know which L&T case he is talking about, but McDougall case. Ah, L&T ka kaun sa wala hai?
Supreme Court. Last one, 2014.
L&T ki baat ye hai ki unke hain bhi sare construction ke.
Unke last one. Supreme Court. ठीक है सर
सर्विस टैक्स वाले की बात कर रहे हैं
आप वैट वाला जो
नहीं एक आया था लार्जर बेंच का वैट वाला हाँ कंस्ट्रक्शन के ही थे लार्जर बेंच का तो ये डिसीजन था कि वर्क्स कॉन्ट्रैक्टर जो बिल्डर आपको फ्लैट बना के बेचता है वो भी वर्क्स कॉन्ट्रैक्टर है एंड ही फॉल्स विद इन सेल्स टैक्स तो इट हैज नथिंग टू डू विद मैकडॉवेल केस मैकडॉवेल के केस में तो हुआ क्या था वो जो मैकडॉवेल कंपनी थी वो 100 रुपए की लिकर बेचती थी और बायर को कहती थी तुम इस लिकर के ऊपर पहले ड्यूटी पे करके आओ तो वो 400 रुपए की ड्यूटी सरकार को पे करके आता था और वो ड्यूटी पेइंग सर्टिफिकेट साथ ले आता था तो वो मैकडॉवेल वाला उसे देखता था अपने एक्साइज वाले को दिखाता था 100 रुपए में उसको लिकर बेच देता था तो क्वेश्चन वॉज कि क्या उसमें 400 ऐड करना है कि नहीं करना फॉर द पर्पज ऑफ सेल्स टैक्स द सुप्रीम कोर्ट सेड दैट इट इज द लायबिलिटी ऑफ द सप्लायर व्हिच हैज बीन डिस्चार्ज्ड बाय द बायर एंड देयरफॉर दिस इज नथिंग बट प्राइस नंबर वन नंबर टू दैट दिस अमाउंट्स टू टैक्स अवॉइडेंस एंड दिस मस्ट बी सीन वेरी स्ट्रिक्टली बाय द कोर्ट्स एंड मस्ट बी अवॉइडेड एंड इट मस्ट बी नॉट कंसिडर्ड एट ऑल कि ये ट्रांजेक्शन हुई है तो आप 500 रुपए टैक्स लगे दैट वॉज मैकडॉवेल
whether free supply value should be included in the construction contract value in terms of section 15(2)(b) whether basis decision of Bhayana builders same be excluded from the value as the contract does specify the supplier to incur expenditure for the said free supplies
isme इसमें थोड़ी सी ना मेरे हिसाब से इनकंसिस्टेंसी है क्वेश्चन में भयाना के केस में सप्लायर को वो इनकर नहीं करना था एक्सपेंडिचर एक्चुअली भयाना के केस में एडमिटेड फैक्ट्स ये थे कि बायर वो चीज देता था जैसे फॉर एग्जांपल वो आपको सीमेंट दे सकता है स्टील दे सकता है तो आप इसको ऐसे समझिए वैसे मैंने कोशिश करी थी ये पॉइंट कवर करने की अज्यूम करिए कि आप एक कॉन्ट्रैक्टर को अपॉइंट करते हैं और आप उसको बोलते हैं मेरा पूरा घर बनाओ और सारा मटेरियल तुम्हें लाना है मैं तुम्हें 3,000 रुपए स्क्वायर फीट के रेट से पैसे दूंगा तो वो 3,000 रुपए जो लगाएगा उस पर जीएसटी लगाएगा पहला प्रिंसिपल ये है दूसरा ये है कि मान लीजिए उस 3,000 रुपए में से मेरे को लगता है वो स्टील अच्छी क्वालिटी का नहीं ला रहा मैं उसको कहता हूँ कि भैया तू अपने घर बैठ स्टील मैं ला के दे रहा हूँ तेरे पैसे काट रहा हूँ द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट सेज दैट स्टील वॉज टू बी सप्लाइड बाय हिम मैंने उसके अंदर 400 रुपए माइनस करके उसके बिल में से और 2600 रुपए उसे दे दिए बिकॉज आई ब्रॉट Still steel would be added because it was his responsibility to provide. वो केस लॉ भी कहता है वो केस मैकडॉवेल भी कहता है वो केस हिंदुस्तान शुगर मिल्स भी कहता है और उसके बाद और केसेस आए थे एंट्री टैक्स में वो NM गोयल वगैरह के जजमेंट आए थे और उन्होंने भी यही बोला था कि डिडक्शन बिल में से आपको एड करना पड़ेगा क्योंकि उसी की रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी थी वो करना नाउ टेक अ थर्ड केस Where the person you appointed was merely a labor contractor. आपने कहा भाई मैं तेरे को 200 रुपए स्क्वायर फीट के हिसाब से दूंगा सारा सामान मैं दूंगा You have to merely construct. Nothing is to be added. आप उसको जो दे रहे हो कुछ नहीं ऐड करना क्योंकि उस वो सप्लाई क्या कर रहा है We have to understand. He is supplying construction services on your materials. वहां पर ऐड नहीं हो तो भयाना बिल्डर का यही रेशियो था जो लास्ट वाला केस है वो केस में भयाना के केस में वो चीज अभी भी अप्लाई करती है जो फ्री है जो अग्रीमेंट में सप्लायर को नहीं देना बायर को ही देना है वो अभी भी ऐड नहीं होगा
सर आरटीओ टैक्स म्युनिसिपल टैक्स कलेक्टेड बाय कार्ड ईयर फ्रॉम कस्टमर एंड पेड टू स्टेट गवर्नमेंट ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द कस्टमर्स इज इट रिक्वायर्ड टू बी एडेड टू ट्रांजैक्शन वैल्यू
देखिए अगर आरटीओ टैक्स की पर्ची कस्टमर के नाम से कटती है अगर रोड टैक्स की पर्ची कस्टमर के नाम से कटती है इफ इन लॉ ही इज द पर्सन लायबल टू मेक पेमेंट ऑफ टैक्स तो इट इज एक्सक्लूडेड इफ इन लॉ इट इज द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ द सप्लायर इन दैट केस इट विल नॉट बी एक्सक्लूडेड इट डिपेंड्स अपॉन द लीगल प्रोविजंस एंड द पर्ची किसके नाम से कटी बोथ द थिंग
सेलर सेल्स गुड्स एक्स फैक्ट्री बट इनकर द ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ ₹1,000 and buyer reimburse rupees 1500, then in rupees, then is rupees 500 taxable? In case reimbursement received is rupees 750, then what will happen?
देखिए वो दूसरी जो सप्लाई कर रहा है ना 1500 वाली, वो आप इसको बंडल्ड सप्लाई में भी ले जा सकते हो, दीज आर ऑल बोथ बंडल्ड, उसके साथ भी ले जा सकते हो, और अगर आप इसको सेपरेट ट्रांसपोर्टेशन का कॉन्ट्रैक्ट दिखाना चाहते हो तो वो भी कर सकते हो, बोथ बोथ थिंग्स आर पॉसिबल। अगर आप बंडल्ड दिखाते हो तो भी 1500 वैल्यू में एड हो जाएगा, अगर आप बंडल्ड नहीं दिखाना चाहते, अगर आप बिल्कुल क्लियरली, जो मैंने एक एग्जाम्पल भी दिया था कि उसके पास अपना एक ट्रांसपोर्टेशन भी है, आप सेपरेट कॉन्ट्रैक्ट करते हो, तो वो एज अ ट्रांसपोर्टेशन सर्विस भी आप उसको दिखा सकते हो। Both options are there, but I think in such like cases, it's better to include it in the supply and then show it and do accordingly.
But sir, in the second situation, what he suggests that this factory owner has incurred expenditure of 1000, but reimbursement has been received 750. That is lesser than what he has incurred. So can we say that it's a pure agent transaction and hence not liable to be taxed?
प्योर एजेंट बिकॉज ही हैज रिसीव्ड लेसर। प्योर एजेंट का मतलब तो बिशन भाई वैसा है, आप ये मानो कि आपको वो काम करना था, आपने उसको कह दिया कि भाई तू ही कर देना ये काम मेरे लिए, तो वो जो थर्ड पार्टी के पास जाएगा तो ही विल से कि ये बिशन भाई का काम करना है, बिशन भाई के नाम से पर्ची बनाओ, मैं तुम्हें पैसे दे रहा हूँ, पर्ची लगाओ, आप अपने बिल के पीछे उस पर्ची को लगाओगे और उसको दे दोगे, आपको वो दे देगा कि जी भैया मैंने ये 750 आपके लिए खर्च किए हैं, तो आप उसको ओवर एंड अबव हिज सप्लाई प्राइस यू विल पे दिस 750 एक्स्ट्रा, दिस इज व्हाट इज मेंट, सो दिस 750 वुड नॉट मेक एनी डिफरेंस इन दैट।
सर कैन सीए चार्ज जीएसटी ऑन रीइंबर्समेंट व्हिच आर नॉट पार्ट ऑफ एंगेजमेंट लेटर?
नहीं, वो एंगेजमेंट लेटर के अगर पार्ट नहीं है तो वो दे रहा है, इसका मतलब देयर इज सम इंप्लाइड कॉन्ट्रैक्ट, अदरवाइज वो देगा ही नहीं आपको, but according to me it is includable in value.
Sir, what will be the value?
You have deliberated on the development rights, value of development rights. Yes, would you like to say something more, sir?
No, I think I have elaborately dealt with on that.
X Limited rented out a premise to Y Limited and charges the fixed monthly rental on which GST is duly paid. However, X Limited recovers the amount of on account of electricity, municipal tax and stamp duty from Y Limited. Whether such amount to be included for the purpose of value of for the purpose of GST or the concept pure agent be exercised, because every time such rule is difficult to follow.
Sir, what happens in renting? They do charge electricity, municipal tax and stamp duty. But I guess electricity is not liable to GST. Also, there is one of the judgment which says that electricity is not liable for service tax. It's in context of the service tax.
उन्होंने तो बोला कि ये sale of goods है.
Yes.
तो ये बोला, बट यहाँ पर उसका फर्क नहीं पड़ेगा, बट यू आर राइट, बिकॉज इट इज इवन इफ यू कंसीडर इट टू बी अ सेपरेट सप्लाई इट विल नॉट बी टैक्सेबल। अग्रीमेंट में क्लियरली लिखना चाहिए कि इलेक्ट्रिसिटी आप यूज करोगे, सो देयरफॉर यू विल बी द यूजर, यू विल बी अर, बेटर दैट द लेसी हिमसेल्फ डायरेक्टली पेज, देन द क्वेश्चन ऑफ दिस इंक्लूजन बिकम्स लेसर इंपॉर्टेंट। स्टैंप ड्यूटी के अंदर लॉज में ज्यादातर लिखा होता है कि द सेलर और बायर बोथ एनीवन कैन पे, तो उस केस में आप बायर से पे करवा देंगे तो वो वैसे भी फिर रिइंबर्समेंट का चक्कर नहीं आएगा, अगर आप पहले पे करके उससे लेंगे देन इट विल बिकम इंक्लूडेबल बिकॉज सेक्शन स्पेसिफिकली सेज सो। और तीसरा आपका केस है म्युनिसिपल टैक्स का, म्युनिसिपल टैक्स भी अगर आप अग्रीमेंट में लिख देंगे दैट ही हैज टू पे देन इट कैन बी एक्सक्लूडेड।
Sir, whether incentive provided by alcoholic beverages company to dealer for purchasing liquor in larger quantities of their brand from state-owned warehouse, as the alcohol cannot be purchased directly from the company, shall be considered as a discount from the original purchase price, or shall be treated as a separate supply of business promotion service provided by the dealer to the beverage company?
इसमें विजन भाई बहुत factual है, I don't, because this involves these are very important questions. I don't want to discuss this type of issue क्योंकि इससे confusion ज़्यादा हो जाता है.
सही है. हाँ सर.
So whether any cross charge is to be made between HON branches if any administrative work has been done by them for each other, and on what value considering there are exempted supply at the recipient end.
मेरे हिसाब से ये question valuation का बाद में है, पहले taxability का है. But मैं इसके ऊपर थोड़ा सा I would like to give my view on this. इसमें अगर आप section 7 के साथ schedule देखोगे तो schedule 1 में ये बोला है, even though that is a supply without consideration, but nonetheless the requirement is that there must be a supply of goods or services or both between related persons or distinct persons. So supply to honi chahiye, there has to be a supplier, there has to be a recipient. Ab ye jo inhone likha hai wo likha hai administrative work. What is administrative work? Administrative work is jo branch ko kaam karna hai wo branch karti hai, jo head office ko kaam karna hai wo head office karta hai. No one ever considers it to be that he is the supplier, I am the recipient. For example, let us take an example. मान लीजिए कि जितने भी sales order बनते हैं, they are all processed at the head office level. Branch office उन्हें procure करती है, वो बना करके भेज देती है और head office level पे वो approve होते हैं. तो क्या हम ये कह सकते हैं कि branch is the provider of service in so far as making of sale order is concerned? Second, can we say that the head office is the recipient of service of making of the sales order? Second question. Third question, can we say that head office is providing the supply of service by approving the sale order? I think no. These are all questions which we are expanding the scope of supply too wide than what it can accommodate. For supplier, there has to be a provider, there has to be a recipient. Whatever works are being done by their individual offices, it is their own work, they have to do it, and there is as such no recipient for such work. Let me take one more example. Head office many a times take policy decisions. Isko bechna hai, kitne mein bechna hai, credit limits kya rakhni hai, marketing strategy kya hogi, advertisement kaise honge. Usse to recipient ko koi matlab hi nahi hai, usko to wo bata dete hain. These are diktats. You have to do it like this, you have to do it like that, usko itna credit dena hai, usko. There is no element of supply in this. It's an act which each one is doing for himself and for the entity as a whole. According to me, it does not involve any supply even within the expanded definition of 7.1 and cannot fall.
So what is the rate for construction service provider to land owner in case of JDA entered into by them? 1.5
or अग्रीमेंट की कैटेगरी पे डिपेंड करेगा. पहली बात तो रेट, ये सबसे ये क्वेश्चन में गलती ये है. एक्चुअली जो रेट ऑफ टैक्स है कंस्ट्रक्शन के ऊपर वो 18% का था कुछ केसेस में, अब उन्होंने उसको ले जाके 7.5% कर दिया. द रेट इज नॉट 5, रेट इज 7.5. इफ लैंड इज एक्सक्लूडेड एट 1/3, यू आर अप्लाइंग दैट रेट टू 2/3 ऑफ द वैल्यू. The result of it may be 5% on the total value, but that doesn't translate into the rate. It actually is a function of rate multiplied by value. So therefore, this question should not be asked in this way. Number two, the taxability, the quantum depends upon the nature of agreement. Agar aapka agreement hai ki tum mere area pe construction karoge, agreement clearly says so. According to me, the notification applying that value of the whole flats cannot apply. That is not the commercial intent. In those cases, it would be 18% of the construction cost, construction value, whichever way. Value has to be determined on the basis of 27, 28, 29, 30, etc. But if you are agreeing ki ji wo first model ki ji maine land de di, ab tum jaano tumhara jaan, jab flat ban jaye to tum mujhe flat de dena, then it would be full 7.5% ke upar, pure ke upar lagega. 7.5 bhi nahi, uske upar to shayad 18 lag jayega. If I'm not wrong, that would be 18 because the rate of tax is not yes, uske upar 18 lag jayega, because that would be even development. No, just a minute. Ha, so it wo to rate to 18 hi rahega is case mein, because these are development, right? In all cases the rate of tax remains 18. The question is only of value. Rate is not, mere hisab se isme ye ded kya likha hua hai, is it 1.5?
1.5
1.5% in case of residential, it is 1.5%, or in residential that is less than 90 square meter affordable.
अच्छा affordable के लिए लिखा है ये.
Yes.
क्योंकि 1.5 करके 2% बन. All right. So वो JT what? But the question is relating to what is the rate for construction service provided to landowner. Oh, so the construction is not the question doesn't pertain. I'm so sorry. The construction doesn't pertain to development rights. It pertains to construction. So in construction, if you are doing construction as a service for the developer, then your output is construction. Construction has to be taxed at 18%.
Yes.
And but अगर आप construction word use कर रहे हैं with land के साथ, जो आपकी भाई you are saying I am giving the whole flat in consideration, then वो फिर 7.5 और 1.5 वाला use होगा.
Sir, we would like to invite you in this unlockdown 2.0 on real estate. So we'll have all those questions to be answered during that.
All right.
Now, free supplies of material that is cement made by the contractor to contractor in case of work contract is to be added for the tax purpose by the contractor if the said procurement of cement was in the scope of contractor. Sir, I guess you have.
I have discussed.
Yes.
It is to be included.
Sir, please throw some light on the current relevance of the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court passed in the case of Super Sinotax reported in 2014, whereby the incentive from the state government was ultimately included in the valuation of the excisable goods.
Actually, they read into the scheme of those provisions, jo aapke Haryana ke aur isko Maruti wagera ke bhi cases the isme, jo tribunal ne sab favor mein kiye hue the. There what used to happen was, if I remember correctly, what used to happen was ki wo jo sales tax lagta tha, wo sales tax aap buyer se nahi collect karte the, wo state aapko reimburse kar deti thi in some form. So what they stated was that since it is reimbursed to you, it is actually given to you, therefore this would not be excluded, because wahan par word likha tha actually paid to the state. So they said you never paid it to the state, you had the right to retain it. Therefore, it is includable. But अभी मेरे को exactly बहुत ज़्यादा याद नहीं है exactly उसमें facts क्या थे. But something like that was there. Since the amount was held to be not actually paid to the state, therefore it was held to be includable. ये उन्होंने बोला था. But it's a very contentious issue, I must tell you.
Yeah.
Because the states, उसमें एक reason मैं आपको बता देता हूँ, which you can, if you have any specific case, you can see. Generally, those schemes used to say कि if you fall under this scheme and the amount is remitted by the state, it would be deemed that you have paid the tax. So actually the Supreme Court, I think, did not give a lot of importance to that deeming fiction, which needs to be brought to the light and then again argued if some issue arises on that issue.
I guess we have covered this. Now let us take an example of because in Gujarat we are not able to see this type of example, but I guess this question has been posted by someone out of Gujarat, where entry fee is rupees 2000 per head and certain quantity of food and liquor will be served in this 2000. If consumption is more than a limit, it will be separately chargeable. Now since liquor is out of purview of GST, whether tax can be levied on entire 2000?
Vision bhai, this again is wholly governed by the terms of contract.
Yes.
I would again not like to give answer to this specific case, but main chota sa idea de do what I'm trying to say. If in the entry, and if at the time of entry you can demonstrate that your agreement with the party is that if out of this 2000 rupees which you pay, this is of course non-refundable, but this is entry fee if you don't consume, it becomes a contingent contract. It is consumption fee if you consume up to this extent, and if you consume more than that, then there would be separate charges. Then this collection of 2000 in advance becomes a contingent collection, attributable to liquor if he consumes liquor, attributable to entry if he doesn't consume liquor. So it would ultimately depend upon the process with the business sets to show that this 2000 rupees which was collected was in fact a contingent receipt.
if there is an oral contract for giving discount post sale, will that discount be excluded from the transaction value?
Yes, 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 surely. The only thing remains is that you have to prove that there was a contract. Proving is an issue there. Law is not an issue.
Sir, I guess we have covered at least 25 questions, and yes, the questions are much more. Till I guess 48 questions are there. So we will take a pause here, and on behalf of Ahmedabad branch and all other branches of Gujarat, that is Anand, Bhavnagar, Bhuj, Gandhidham, Jamnagar and Rajkot, we are thankful to you, sir, for deliberating your topic in detail, in depth, and not only that, you have given answers of 25 questions, and we exceeded the time more than 45 minutes. So, sir, I am thankful from bottom of my heart to given your precious time for discussion. I am also thankful to all the participants who have actively participated in this webinar series, joined here and also posted the questions. So with this, we are ending this GST webinar series here, but it's a beginning. You people are required to think on it, and we are definitely going to circulate summary notes of all these sessions along with the all questions which are posted during the session with answers from the faculty. Or we are also having a GST Sahayata help desk at branch formed by our chairman Fenil Shah under the leadership of Indirect Tax Committee of ICI New Delhi. So we will try to take views of all the experts, and we will make a note of this and we'll circulate it. Thank you very much all for being here. Thank you, Purit.
Thank you, Bishan bhai. Thank you to the branch. Thank you to all the participants.